Ryan Reynolds here from Mint Mobile.
With the price of just about everything going up during inflation, we thought we'd bring our prices down. So to help us, we brought in a reverse auctioneer, which is apparently a thing.
Mint Mobile Unlimited Premium Wireless. How to get 30, 30, how to get 30, how to get 20, 20, 20, how to get 20, 20, how to get 15, 15, 15, 15, just $15 a month? Sold!
Give it a try at mintmobile.com/switch.
$45 up front for 3 months plus taxes and fees. Promo rate for new customers for limited time. Unlimited more than 40 gigabytes per month. Slows full terms at mintmobile.com.
This podcast contains mature content, explicit language, suggestive situations, and partial to full frontal nudity. Listener discretion is advised. Don't let your kids listen to this.
Timeline's never been this fucked up.
No, oh my God.
It's more fucked up than ever before.
Without looking it up, I was trying to think of what comes out next week. I had to look it up. I couldn't remember what we had done.
I don't know.
You don't know what comes out next week? After the Bye Bye Man.
No, I'm trying to think who the daisy chain was.
It was Doug Jones. Does that help?
It was Doug Jones again?
Yeah, he went back to back.
Oh, Fantastic Four. No, we already did Fantastic Four.
Yeah, we already did. It's already out.
Doug Jones. I'm stumped. I know he's some creature or some shit like that.
You filed it.
I don't know.
Did you file for the dumbest fucking reason too?
Did I file Bye Bye Man?
Because they use a Mac with Windows or something like that.
Yes.
Oh yeah. No. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Shit.
Internet Explorer on a Mac in the car.
That's what it is. Yeah.
Shit. Who is it?
Still don't know.
I'm blank. I'm drawing a blank. What movie?
Men in Black 2.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
You sound real excited about that file.
No, I think about it. I was like, no, that's not a file.
It's a cosmic mix of the action of the 90s combined with the exploitation films of the 70s. But with modern touches, it's hyper-violence, but it knows that it is. It's a little bit Tarantino. It's definitely a little bit Michael Mann. It's kind of a cosmic gumbo. It almost moves to the beat of jazz.
People are genetically inferior, or they're culturally crippled, or they're socially deprived.
How come God couldn't make everyone one color, like tan?
I wish I'd fucked a black broad before I got married.
I could really feel 400 years of oppression and anger in every pelvic thrust.
I can smell horny across an ocean.
Not all women.
Good for you, man. Good for you, good for you.
Just the hot ones.
Hello, Oprah.
You're not allowed to go down on me for 1 month.
No, Judith,
don't
please.
Don't make me take away your masturbation privileges.
Yeah, I'm horny too, baby.
Hey, Charmin, come on down here. Will you want to exercise my dominance?
It's scaring.
I'm getting a patriarchal urge. Look out for number one.
Mind me, just keep doing what you're doing. We're a team. We work together.
I don't know if you were paying attention.
I was.
Please, goddammit! Just one more drink! I'll cut off your tits with a knife, you bitch!
5 whiskeys. That's breakfast on the river.
Yo, you have to clip it, Maze.
Clip what? A fucking tiger? What are you talking about?
It's not that hard. Just chop, chop, boom, out.
Wow, Maze has a really hard job.
This is going to be the worst episode we've ever done.
My people don't give a ding-dong diddly about what flag fly over Hawaii.
You bore me, Fury.
Where is the Miqua film?
It's nothing but a bag of meat and flesh and tendon.
Why didn't they just name him Spaghetti Lasagna?
Fuck, this movie's 2 hours long?
Not the whole thing.
This is like the John Gruden emails of movies.
Do you like ducks?
Or a trench coat full of bees flying around? Like, that would scare me.
Bees are cool.
That's a duck, man.
No, I get it.
Coolio.
You're the devil's baby mama.
I didn't lie, Annie. I just didn't tell you certain things.
Don't play no reindeer games with me.
An American ninja? What are you talking about? There's no such thing.
Set your sights on the stars and the sun. Look out for number one. You gotta push a little hard, push a little hard, yeah, yeah.
You've gotten rich off of the people in this town.
You bet you
richer as I have. And I'm going to get richer.
Coughlin's law.
Go into incredibly descriptive details of the story so we all know.
Oh, man. I wish I had better notes.
Have you ever heard such a pail of shite?
Once I get a DVD player, I'm going to watch Gallo Walkers once a day.
Come here and give me a squudge.
You know what to do from here, Internet.
All right, cool. Let me Google how to open QuickTime.
Justice is blind.
He's got space dementia.
But it can be heard.
Time to find out exactly what this ooze can do.
Pull the fucking rabbit out of your dick and phobe.
I'm Temecula's newest hard-on, dog.
Hey, looky here. Why don't we eat us a few thousand beers and you can tell me what's buzzing in the big bad city.
Come on, yeah! You gotta look out for number one. Set your sights on the stars.
Fuck you, fuck you. You're cool. And fuck you, I'm out.
Welcome to Cinephobe. Let's try that again.
Did you pull a muscle or something? What happened?
I don't know what happened. It's like halfway through that, my throat just decided, nah, we're good.
Dude, you're not trying to hit a high note. Fuck.
Leave all this in. Try that again. Welcome to Cinephobe. Still doesn't feel right, but that's the podcast. We break down the movies you're afraid to admit you love. I'm Zach Harper. That's Amin El Hassan. That's Anthony Mayes. What your reviews? You Babadooks. Make sure you send in your reviews.
6,289 on Apple.
That feels like it went down to me.
From Dutch 80, five-star pod. Can I get an Amin? Mayes has a really hard job. Pay the whales, save the teachers. Please do Angels in the Outfield for a future episode.
Wow.
And please give your boy Dylon a shout-out on the pod. So there you go, Dylon. Shout-out.
Dylon. Top five rappers ever.
Yep.
Are you trying to get some of this hot fire?
Leave us a five-star review. It sounded like you were in between. Should I do the voice? Should I not do the voice?
Yeah. Sounds like Ernie Hudson.
Oh, future call back.
Oh, man. We got a real battle for Louis Pinnock, man.
Oh, my God. You know, the way it unveils for me. Once again, I've seen this movie. I don't remember anything from it. So it was as if I was watching it for the first time. And imagine my delight at every stage when there's a surprise.
I don't remember so many people trying to fuck this gorilla.
Oh, what?
Well, that's the fresh eyes of 2023, Zach, that you bring into this experience.
Hey, leave us a review. I want to make sure that you're checking out CT5 on this feed. In your review, leave your CT5 suggestion, leave your CT5 list, leave your Cinephobe suggestion, whatever you got. Also, make sure you signed up for the Patreon, patreon.com/countthedings, where you get access to all of our Rewatchington live events. Also access to the old ones, Teen Witch, The Fanatic, Never Back Down, all of them. And you get ad-free episodes on the Patreon. Also, got this episode Wednesday night. Maze, I don't know if that's a regular thing. But this came out a little early for the Patreon subscribers.
Sometimes I get a little frisky and maybe I sneak up an episode a little early. I put up top five worst picks before the weekend just because I felt like it.
Yeah.
Also, check out at CinephobePod on Instagram. Just got that going.
Oh, yeah.
Been posting old clips from the movies, screenshots, memes by Snacky Tuna, art by Mark Ordner. It's real goulash of Cinephobe moments.
It's a cosmic gumbo.
Kind of a cosmic gumbo.
Yeah, Ryan and I would joke on set about it being a cosmic gumbo.
Was it Street Kings where you kept clipping?
Crashmore? You mean Crashmore, the movie that we did starring Keanu Reeves?
You knew I'd like that fucking gun.
Dude, for those who don't know, it's a skit in which Santa Claus is also a Hollywood actor, action star.
Seen every cock on the planet.
They show us a trailer of the movie And then they go on AOL Blast, and Santa Claus takes you behind the scenes of his experience.
If you have a submission, submit it. Reminder, needs to be 40% or lower on the Rotten Tomatoes audience or critics score. All right, fire up that hot, hot Daisy Chain music. The deepest Daisy Chain we've ever had.
Isn't it always the deepest?
Chain, chain, chain. Chain, chain, chain.
Neeson month led us to Blacklight.
It didn't.
Aidan Quinn took us to Practical Magic. Sandy Bullock took us to Speed 2 Cruise Control. Tamara Morrison gave us Barbed Wire. Clint Howard then gave us Waterboy. Brett Rice, who we all know, took us to Fled. Lawrence Fishburne went back to back with The Ice Road and then again to Event Horizon. Jack Noseworthy gave us Encino Man. Jeffrey Anderson Gunter took us to Don't Be a Menace. Tracy Sherelle Jones, obviously Jones, not Davis, brought us to Bringing Down the House. Eugene Levy sent us on a journey with Almost Heroes. Christopher Guest linked us to The Invention of the Lion. Jonah Hill, topical, took us to Accepted and then Grandma's Boy, or maybe he's not anymore, I don't know.
Ask me about my misogyny.
Oh, there's a clip. Rob Schneider gave us You Don't Mess with the Zohan. Manuel Shrieky set us for Waiting. Dane Cook brought us Simon Says. Ricky Harris flooded us with Hard Rain. Something called Michael Monks fucked us to death into Street Kings.
For the fellas.
Chris Evans took us to Fantastic Four Rise of the Silver Surfer. Doug Jones, third to go back to back. He said hello to the Bye Bye Man. And then he went back to back with Men in Black 2. And I am using Kevin Grevioux to take us to the 1995 action adventure mystery Congo.
Mystery? I had science fiction action adventure. What's the mystery? I guess the Lost City?
The mystery of the city of Zinj, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I think I might like yours better, though. Not really science fiction, though. It's just technology.
No, it's Michael Crichton. I feel like he's a science fiction all on his own.
He doesn't just get to put science.
He does.
No, he doesn't.
Because he made up fictional science. I think it's right on.
He didn't make it up.
He's all about this fictional science. Man, I can't wait to talk about it.
You can't say he made up fictional science.
There's that laser.
What? That laser.
He shot the moon.
Spoiler alert.
Dude, this movie, man.
Or Tinker's Jets.
The notes talking about other movies in this movie is going to be insane.
All right. Congo stars Laura Linney, Tim Curry, and Ernie Hudson. This is the first time for Laura on Cinephobe. She was in Dave and Searching for Bobby Fischer in 1993, A Simple Twist of Fate in 94, this movie in 95, and then Primal Fear in 1996, which, by the way, Paramount Plus just started playing after I was done with Congo.
Then Truman Show and You Can Count on Me after that. This was her first big leading role.
Tim Curry was in Rocky Horror Picture Show, Clue, Home Alone 2, and he's a repeat offender for Loaded Weapon 1.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Well, is the microfilm. He's also got Oscar and Three Musketeers, the 93 edition.
Get a hell of a resume, man.
On the board as potential cinephobes.
You know Ernie from Ghostbusters, Ghostbusters 2, Airheads, future cinephobe, and repeat offender for Mr. Magoo and The Watcher.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
He's also in Smokin' Aces 2, Assassin's Ball. That's a good name.
And Dragon Ball Evolution, which is a dumpster fire of a movie that we'll do someday.
I'll take your word for it.
We also get Dylan Walsh, Grant Heslove,
Dylan,
and Joe Don Baker.
Oh, Joe Don Baker.
Dylan was in The Lake House. Grant was in future cinephobe License to Drive and True Lies. Joe was in Fletch, The Distinguished Gentleman, and Mars Attacks.
Dylan Walsh was the other star of Nip Tuck.
Oh.
Alongside Julianne McMahon. And I had him as a possible next Jim Carrey contender, but I think really...
It's Amy.
They couldn't get anybody better.
Oh.
For this part.
Yeah, I think that's what it was.
It's not like, this is the guy, he's gonna be awesome. It was, everybody said no.
Laura Linney's the next Jim Carrey.
Oh.
But she actually fulfilled.
But she delivered.
Oh, so I guess if you're the next Jim Carrey, you have to like fail, right?
Yeah, I think part of the next Jim Carrey is you have to fall short of that.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, then it is Amy. just so you know, we got a race for ass off, man. We got an absolute race.
So I'm just going to read this note now.
This honest podcaster.
I don't know if Zach is going to say Amy is ass on or ass off. He's going to go really hard one direction or the other.
There are times where I am blown away by the acting.
Dishonest podcaster. Dishonest podcaster.
Mary Ellen Trainer from Die Hard, The Goonies, Lethal Weapon, Ricochet, the whole Lethal Weapon franchise, actually. Future Cinephobe Greedy, Tony Medley Obsession, Freaky Friday, and she's a repeat offender for Action Jackson.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
One scene in this movie.
Carolyn Seymour, repeat offender from Mortal Kombat Annihilation.
Mm-hmm.
Seymour Butts.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Lawrence T. Rents, repeat offender from White Man's Burden.
T. Rents too high.
Theodore Rents.
John Hawks, repeat offender from Johnny B. Good.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Jimmy Buffett.
What?
Repeat offender from Hook.
Yeah.
And Club Dread?
And Club Dread.
Question mark?
No, the Beach Bum.
Well, he's also in Club Dread, sort of.
He's mentioned in Club Dread.
He's in Club Dread as much as Coolio is in any of these movies.
You want Jimmy Buffett to get a half point for Club Dread is what you're saying?
I do, actually. Yeah, if we could do that. Thom Barry, repeat offender from White Man's Burden.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Thom.
T-H-O-M is not Tom, it's Thom, okay?
Thom Maker.
Thom Barry has a resume, dude. Independence Day, High School High. He's Michael Jordan's dad in Space Jam.
You can't say he has a resume and then the second one in is High School High. That doesn't work.
I can, because that's a future cinephobe that comes up all the time, so it has to be mentioned.
Also, High School High, file. That movie's a banger.
Air Force One, Steel, Fast and the Furious, Too Fast, Too Furious.
Our Daisy Chain Link, Kevin Grevioux. Repeat offender from Men in Black 2 and Great White Hype.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Bruce Campbell from Evil Dead, Army of Darkness, and Escape from L.A. E.J. Callahan, repeat offender from Wild Wild West and Envy. Garen Michael, repeat offender from Zookeeper. David St. Pierre, repeat offender from Hulk. Philip Tan, repeat offender from Tango and Cash. Christopher Critter Antonucci, repeat offender from Takers. And also Delroy Lindo.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Repeat offender from Gone in 60 Seconds. Uncredited in this movie.
Uncredited, but ass off.
Yes, completely ass off.
Very disappointed.
And Joe Pantaleono.
Joey Pants.
Repeat offender from Bad Boys 2, Adventures of Pluto Nash, and Daredevil.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Also, Adewale Akinoye Agbaje, who's Adebisi on Oz, Mr. Echo on Lost, and he's in The Mummy Returns. This is his first movie.
Congo was directed by Frank Marshall. Frank directed Arachnophobia, Alive, and Eight Below.
He is the husband of Kathy Kennedy and the co-founder of Amblin Entertainment. That's the Steven Spielberg edition, not the Liam Neeson edition, which makes him a repeat offender for producing Hook.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
He also produced Indiana Jones, Back to the Future, the Bourne movies, The Sixth Sense, and a shitload of other movies.
We got a writing credit from John Patrick Shanley. Wrote the screenplay. He wrote Moonstruck, Joe vs. the Volcano, Alive, and Doubt. Won an Oscar for Best Writing in Moonstruck, 1988. And Michael Crichton gets a credit for the novel. He's now a repeat offender for Disclosure.
Part about Michael Crichton that I always forget is that he created ER.
I didn't remember that.
Westworld, Jurassic Park, Twister. Yeah, that makes sense. That all feels like Michael Crichton. But he created ER, which ran for a million years.
Fictional science.
Also, Future Cinephobes, Rising Sun, Sphere, and Timeline got fucked up.
Oh my God.
Sphere is a mess of a movie.
Timeline's a mess of a movie.
Synopsis for Congo. When an expedition to the African Congo ends in disaster, a new team is assembled to find out what went wrong.
No, it's when an exposition is assembled. Fuck me, man.
Tagline, where you are the endangered species.
Mm.
That's not bad.
Yeah.
Okay.
Also kind of a future callback.
That's pretty good. And it's the only one. They nailed it. $50 million estimated budget, grossed $81 million US, $152 million worldwide. That is a hit.
I'm pretty surprised it was only $50
million. Same.
There's a lot of stuff in this movie for $50 million.
Well, I'm guessing they got a deal on gorilla suits.
No, they did not. We'll talk about that extensively.
Oh, really?
The trivia is very gorilla suit heavy.
Yeah.
Heavy gorilla suits.
I mean, you said it all right there.
Before we jump into this movie and you listen to the rest of this podcast, Congo is available on Paramount Plus or Showtime.
Is it? By the time this episode drops.
It might have been.
At one point in time.
I rarely pick a rental. rental.
Well, that's not true.
Now, there have been a few lately, but I rarely pick a rental.
We try not to pick rentals, but sometimes the shit falls off the streaming service. What are we supposed to do?
Congo receives 20% from the critics on 50 reviews on Rotten Tomatoes, 29% from the audience on over 50,000 ratings. Amin, would you like the positive or the negative reviews?
It sounds like everybody shit on it. Give me the positives.
Hey, John, that's weird. That glass looks half full to me.
Wow. Now that you mention it, it is half full.
Jay Olson of Cinemixtape. A goofy mess whose screws aren't loose, but missing entirely. Felix Vasquez Jr. of Cinema Crazed. I love it because it's good, and yet so bad, it's good. Jeffrey M. Anderson, Combustible Celluloid.
Mandrew.
Well, it used to be Mandrew, but now all I think about is Jeffrey Anderson Gunter.
It's fairly ridiculous. The apes are clearly people in suits, but it's light and brisk and fun with a nice open air feel.
Light and brisk and fun?
It looks like they're in a soundstage.
Wait till that note comes up. 5 minutes into the movie.
James Jennings of Film 4.
JJ.
Revel in the sheer insanity and unique humor of this cracking jungle adventure. Gene Offmuth of Palo Alto Weekly. A lighthearted, good old-fashioned jungle adventure.
What?
Robert Roten of Laramie Movie Scope.
Mr. Roten.
If you want to dwell on details, you won't like this film. But if you just sit back and relax and try not to be crabby, it is a lot of fun. User Jealousiege J, 3.5 out of 5 stars.
Oh, I love Jealousiege J.
I am just green with jealous rage right now.
An underrated dark comedy adventure film that deals with a lost city and man-killing apes. A guilty pleasure film for me, and all caps, I'm proud of it.
Nice.
Blank user, 5 out of 5. This movie isn't great by any means, but it's fun as F. I saw this in the theaters in 1995. Me and my brother still laugh so much at it. I mean, is this you? I'd buy this on 4K if they release it. I feel like it's a cult classic. You had to be a teen in the 90s to appreciate this. From Amy, Good Gorilla, Amy Want Green Drop Drink to Stop Eating My Sesame Cake. Classic. Fun and entertaining. Oh, and the big building that's supposed to be Travis Communication, the exterior, when they're in the golf cart and walking up to the huge building with the pond.
Yeah,
that's actually Kaiser Permanente Hospital down by LA.
That place gets used a lot.
Laughing emoji. Love it. Too funny.
Is it?
Isn't it? Welcome
to
Cinephobe.
Shout out to Amy and her green drop drink.
Fucking drunk. Drunk ass gorilla.
Oh, I don't want to burn notes.
She's a loud one.
I don't want to burn notes.
Negative reviews.
Stop being a pessimist. This tank is not half full. It's half empty.
Mal Vincent of the Virginian Pilot. The first major mistake in a summer that has already netted several commercial blockbusters. Quentin Curtis of Independent on Sunday.
King of Diamonds Monday.
It's a shocker. Clunkingly written, dismally acted, haphazardly directed, and with some of the most glaringly conspicuous sound stages masquerading as the African jungle ever seen in a major American movie.
Did they run out of money?
I don't know.
The producer directed it, so... should have been on him to find more money.
Brian Lowry of Variety.
My Lowry.
Feels as if the picture were edited to leave the action sequences in while removing any connecting material that might have helped them make sense.
Oh, man, I have some criticisms about some of those action sequences.
Really?
Yes.
Can't imagine how. Michael Dukina of themoviereport.com.
Not black enough.
Oh. Ineptly written, feebly acted, clumsily directed yawner of an adventure yarn. Blake Davis of K4, Channel 4 News, OKC.
Did a voice.
Not funny bad, just bad. The worst adaptation of a Michael Crichton book so far.
Southern Nut Prospector.
I gotta disagree, man. I thought it was funny bad.
Very funny. I laughed throughout this whole fucking movie, man.
I was laughing a lot.
This is one of the best comedies we've ever done. Kenneth Turin of LA Times. The entire tone of the book has been transformed from tension to tongue-in-cheek with dismal results.
The book was filled with tension? What? I'm pretty sure the movie was filled with tension.
They really fucked that gorilla, man. You haven't read the book in a while.
Some tongue also.
Steve Davis of Austin Chronicle. It suffocates you with one faux thrill after another. And then a couple of user reviews. Blank user, 2 out of 5 stars. Before there was Andy Serkis, there was Amy, the cyborg gorilla. Yet surprisingly, the prosthetically enhanced primate is not the most absurd, unbelievable character. That's a toss-up between all the rest. Ex-CIA computer scientist Laura Linney, Ernie Hudson doing a Cary Grant impression, Tim Curry playing a Romanian Tim Curry. It's like a movie as a whole slipped on a banana peel.
Get this guy on as a guest.
I know, this guy. Maybe he should replace one of us. All of us? I don't know. Blank user, half star out of five. One of the worst movies ever made. Pathetic storyline along with some horrendous acting. It's so soapy, you could wash a car with it. Anyone who thought this crap was any good would be deaf, dumb, and blind. And then final one, blank user, 2 out of 5. I liked when Amy the Gorilla called Laura Linney ugly. Same note too.
It gave the movie an extra star based on that. Huh?
All right, we're going to get a Amin's first note, May's first note, and my first note after these pre-recorded messages, unless you're a Patreon subscriber.
Yeah.
Then you're getting all these ad-free.
Right now.
Listener, what's up? Zach Harper, coming to you live from just making my picks on Prize Picks, the largest daily fantasy sports platform in North America. For my money and your money, the easiest and most exciting way to play DFS. Again, that's daily fantasy sports. It's just you against the numbers. Instead of battling thousands of players, including like pros and sharks, those people that really try to game the system and screw you over, you just pick more or less on 2 to 6 player stat projections and watch the winnings roll in. Basketball's here, right? So check this out. This is the cool thing that I love from Prize Picks. You can now pick combo projections across football and basketball from the Specials League, a league created specifically for combo projections that includes 2 or more players from different sports and leagues. So if you want to do like more Patrick Mahomes yards and less James Harden points, you can do that. You can do that combination. You can do any combination that they have on there. You just go to the Specials League. You want to play alongside people? Maybe you don't want to go it alone. Maybe you want to play alongside people. You can go to, I don't know, Meek Mill, Andrew Schultz. You find them in the community plays under the promos tab of the app to view entries from some of the biggest names in the Prize Picks community each week. And best of all, Prize Picks even offers a reboot policy so your entries stay in play even if one of your players gets injured. For football and basketball games, if you have the player who exits the game in the first half and does not return the second, that player is rebooted. Prize Picks, the only daily fantasy sports platform with an injury insurance policy. So I'll tell you what you do. You go to prizepicks.com/ding and use the promo code DING, D-I-N-G, for a first deposit match up to $100. Let me say that again for you. You go to prizepicks.com/DING. You use the code DING, D-I-N-G, for a first deposit match up to $100 from our friends at Prize Picks. Prize Picks, daily fantasy sports made easy. Amin, what is your first note?
So we open on like this scenic view of the Congo, and I said, New Jersey.
Say New Jersey?
Yeah. The movie's called Congo, and it felt like Venom.
Venom, Venom.
Where are we, guys? Where are we? That's right. Trolley cars, Golden Gate Bridge. So I was just like, New Jersey. Nice establishing shot.
Maze?
This sun shining on the savannah makes me think of Batman and Robin.
8 more minutes in a city full of Gothamites or ice cubes forever.
Sunlight could reverse a freezing process.
We'll sunrise in 5 hours.
Here.
But it's morning in the Congo.
If we could relay the sunlight
from the other side of the equator.
It'll take the satellites about a minute to realign, but...
Sunlight from the Congo.
Future note too. Just one of those days.
Completely forgot that part.
Oh, really? I thought you would have been a lock for that.
Yeah. Mace, please clip this song, by the way. Banger.
My first note, I remember reading the book and being so hyped for this movie.
Wow. Really?
I remember the same thing happening with The Sphere. Moral of the story, never read. Never read books.
Shorty can't eat no books, dog.
Zach, same note too, bro. I stopped reading fiction because of Michael Crichton books that turned into awful movies.
Really?
And ironically, the one that set it all up was Jurassic Park, which was actually a really good movie. But when I first watched Jurassic Park, I thought it was trash because
really
the book was so amazing. Yeah, man.
Look at this basic ass Photoshop glow effect on the Congo title card. I did the same thing with every Ricky Davis picture in history. These lions are ass off. These lions are incredible, by the way. Are you kidding me?
Herds of wildebeest, lions chilling in the shade, giraffes.
I kind of want to go on a safari.
Like for the pod?
But, sure, for the pod, but I've kind of met. For me, I'm terrified of lions, but They don't kill you, right?
What a ridiculous thing to be terrified of, man.
Everyone always says that, and then you get the breaking news, lion escapes the zoo. Okay, I'm not hearing it. They freak me out, man. They freak me out.
Looking at them on TV freaks you out?
They just look so powerful.
They are, you bingo.
I know, you Babadook, but they... Oh, that didn't sound good. But I just imagine, like, there's nothing I could do with it.
There isn't.
But oddly enough, not afraid of gorillas.
Even after this movie?
Especially after this movie.
Wow.
Reinforced everything for me.
The myth of the killer ape?
Yeah.
This has to be brought up 8 million times. It's a myth.
We got a team with gear in a village. They're hiking in the jungle. Hey, it's Bruce Campbell.
There's a village with a kid wearing a Chicago Bears sweatshirt, a French sign that says, Le Volcan de Virunga.
They hike with the fervor of Instagram influencers. Just a real lazy hike.
I really enjoy when we're trying to establish we're at a busy camp and the camera is pulling out and people keep walking back and forth. They're not doing anything.
No.
It's just milling about.
You know those like shooting gallery games at the carnival?
Yep.
Where you shoot and then it goes back the other way and you shoot and it goes back the other. That's basically what they're doing.
Yeah.
There's a microscope, so we know they're scientists. Bruce Campbell's got a gun. They're hiking up Mount Mukenko.
The backup to Mount Matumbo.
Cut to a satellite in space? What?
Oh, that's not...
That's not a satellite.
A CGI satellite.
TraviCom.
We're setting up camp in the jungle and doing a gear check, and holy fuck, the CGI on that satellite.
That was abrupt. And now we're fading to a huge satellite dish in Houston. Laura Linney is rushing around. They have the satellite from the Congo. Ah, he said it in the first line of the movie.
I noticed this. You say the Congo instead of Congo.
Someone's calling for Dr. Ross, Dr. Ross. And I said, we got ass on in this movie. Because whoever's on the PA is super ass on when Dr. Ross appears. I said, oh shit, that's the mom from Ozark.
Got some exposition about changing the security code every 3 hours per the old man. He just says Rudy like a bingo 4 times and the lock goes green.
Yeah.
Receiving a transmission. We know this because we've got some graphic exposition on the screen.
Oh, we also got jargon and banter. All in one.
7 volcanoes, and he picks the right one. His luck has finally changed.
We've got a link up with Charles in the Congo and Karen in the Texas. I read you and I see you.
Satellite FaceTime in 1995.
Eureka and all that. I found the bloody thing. The earth shakes. He says this whole place does the shimmy. She just wants to know if he actually found it. He
found chemically flawless blue diamond alluvia.
Jargon.
Johnny on the spot phasic laser. Says it'll look raw without a real diamond.
Woo-hoo!
And he shoots a plant with a laser. It lights on fire. And Laura is excited by this.
Oh, she's very excited.
My note, this movie is about laser guns?
Oh, yeah.
That's the part that really threw me off.
There's your sci-fi.
Laser guns, not science fiction.
It is. It's fictional science.
They have laser guns.
No.
They have laser guns.
No, Zach, there are no laser guns.
Okay, big government. Yeah, they don't have it at all. You got it.
It's me, you, and him, not me, you, him, and the NSA.
Also, yet another Batman and Robin connection here. A diamond-powered weapon? Yep. What was going on in the mid-90s, man?
Nothing but diamonds and lasers, diamonds and freeze guns. They found sand in a mineral stream. Jeffrey's gone off in search of the source. He wants Jeffrey to share in the glory, so they'll link up in 1 hour. And she can't get the coordinates before he turns off the link.
Because he's too busy buying a boat named Live Forever.
Yes.
Charles and Jeffrey convene. Jeffrey thinks he really found something, says to jump into the lagoon. He jumps in. Charles follows. They swim under a rock formation. And oh my God, soundstage is going to be a horseman.
Holy shit. It looks like someone's living room with some potted plants.
Yeah.
Followed by, what is this? It's a small soundstage.
Very small, yeah.
They couldn't get the big one, and so they put them into the auxiliary run.
This would later be turned into the plane from Money Plane.
Yeah, exactly.
There's a temple there. Jeffrey thinks it's a big deal and a big find. Sculptures of gorillas. Charles says they're getting the old man in Houston, so come on camera and share the glory.
He's going to grab his bag, which he left inside dense brush.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Have to.
Jeffrey's going to live forever, isn't he?
And now we're back in Houston. Joe Don Baker is the old man who gets off a golf cart holding a golf club.
Yeah, just in case you didn't know.
And he is horny for this diamond.
He's got slacks. He's got a blazer. He's got a golf club. He's psyched.
He also has some walk and talk exposition about diamonds and lasers.
With the right laser and diamonds like that, we can dominate the communications industry overnight. A communications laser?
Oh, yeah.
What?
Well, you shoot all the satellites out of the sky that aren't yours, and all of a sudden... You're the leader.
Look, Mays, do you want 56K or not?
Yeah, exactly.
Is that what it takes?
Absolutely.
A laser.
I didn't realize that broadband was run on diamond lasers. My bad, guys. That was ignorant of me.
Laura says the laser could punch a hole in the moon.
We're taking steps.
Come on.
Menage a note.
And he shushes her. Don't say it so loud. Your move, Idris Elba. The only thing harder than a diamond is this guy four diamonds. That is the only thing.
I'm like a diamond in an ice storm right now.
Here's your callback, by the way.
Back in the jungle, Jeff hasn't come back yet. It's supposed to transmit in 10 minutes. He busts out a Hershey's chocolate bar for some product placement.
20 CB product placement.
No.
A plain Hershey bar is not good, guys.
People just eating a Hershey bar, man?
Hold on.
In the mid-90s? No way.
Are we saying Hershey bars are not 21st century, man?
Dude, they might be 19 CB.
They're timeless is what they are.
No, they're not.
I don't agree with that at all.
The only reason you buy them is for s'mores. No one's just chewing on a Hershey bar. Raw dog.
When's the last time you ate a plain Hershey bar?
Here comes the lie.
I don't eat chocolate bars like that. That's the problem.
Yeah.
So why are you caping up for it,
Raul?
Because I see people eating them.
Okay.
You guys are making them seem like this rare thing that no one does anymore.
You don't see people eating them. Don't say that.
I think it's an old person candy.
Damn.
They hear a noise, then something is thrown at Charles. It's an eyeball.
Film noir.
Charles, look to me in my eyeball.
Bruce yells with his ass off as he looks up at a growl.
Yeah, the classic, we're not going to reveal what it is. Frank Marshall worked too much with Steven Spielberg. He tried to do the Jaws thing.
Well, they didn't want people to leave the theater once they saw.
They want everybody to see the creatures at the end.
You leave in the first 10 minutes, you get your money back. You leave an hour and a half in, you're not getting your money back.
Mm-mm-mm.
They're awaiting transmission in Houston. 10 minutes late, they activate the remote link. We just see a table on the camp.
JDB wants the camera to pan, and the tech uses an enormous,
oh my God,
20 CB ball mouse. I tried to look this thing up. I couldn't even find it. It is crazy looking.
Shout out to the ball mouse, man.
Oh, the ball mouse was such a great invention.
It rotates to reveal that, okay, everyone's dead.
They're not just dead. They've been brutally murdered.
What's the end game?
These pets from Ballers?
Then a monkey runs in front of the camera.
No, 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 no. Then someone in a gorilla suit moves by the camera.
Lock your remote back scan. Give me a thermal readout resolve to 6.6.
Jargon.
Karen is so quick with the jargon, man.
But she jargons her ass off. And this was like early in the movie. I'm like, oh, she's good and everyone else isn't.
Yes. I see seven dead people. Your move, Haley Joel Osment. Old man wants to know what that sound is. Gorilla knocks over the camera right in front of a brutalized face, and then the transmission goes out. But it was that 20 CB of how TVs used to turn off.
Mm-hmm. Static first.
With that decreasing white circle.
Oh, yeah.
He smashes the screen with his golf club that he's been carrying around for this exact purpose.
Ah.
She asks for the code. He yells, "Do what I say!" He's ass-odd overacting, dude. He is going way too hard.
But at least he went for it, okay?
Oh, he definitely went for it.
I don't think he's ass-on. I don't think he's ass-off either.
No, he's ass-on.
He's ass-on here?
Yeah, man.
He wants to keep things under wraps. Laura says they'll have to notify the families. They can't decide if it was a baboon or a gorilla.
We don't know he's dead. We didn't see him. Once this is reported, they'll close the border.
Gorillas didn't kill all those people. Gorillas don't do that. How does he know that?
Everybody knows the myth of the killer gorilla. Come on, man.
Killer gorilla.
He says, could have been locals. And I said, oh.
Same hope, too.
Could have been some locals. A rival company.
Please don't go off into one of your paranoid fantasies.
I need those diamonds, Dr. Ross.
Are you for real?
It's the future.
Most people think they're children of the future.
I've got 40,000 people working for me. They all depend on me. This satellite is our communications cash cow. In 3 years, it'll be obsolete. I need a new cash machine. This diamond, this is it. Charles knew that. That's why I went down to that godforsaken place.
Charles went into the Congo to please you.
I know you had feelings for him.
I almost married him, for Christ's sake. Listen to me, talking like he's...
Two things. He was battling her for ass on, but he started delivering at the end. And number two, racist.
I call it boss man exposition.
Jodan Baker is going to send her down there. She's good in the field, was good in Panama.
Ah.
They'll track the laser's power pack, take over an existing expedition.
Exposition.
Doesn't understand, but he's hurrying before Zaire shuts the border.
Zaire, 20th century, bitch.
20 CB.
Are you human? I'll be human later.
Oh, what a line.
Ass off, Golden Dumpster. I mean, he redeemed himself completely.
Same note, too. That's why I was like, he's not ass off, but like, he's definitely not ass on, man. You guys are unimpressible.
He'll have some people waiting when she gets down. They're good people. It turns out that Bruce Campbell is his son, so this is reverse poppy talk. Find out what happened to Charles. Yeah, tell me you love your son. I do, and that's why you're sending me. It is ass on for the character. She oddly threatens to make him sorry. If I have one moment where I feel otherwise, I will make you sorry. That's a promise. She's terrible. Chekhov's promise.
Mayes, please clip this nigga ADR at Berkeley.
Oh my God.
Met this girl named Heather. And she's like totally dreamy. I mean, you wouldn't believe. And I was like, what I believe? What is Heather doing? What does she do that I wouldn't believe?
You gotta subscribe to find out.
OnlyFans.
My girl named Heather. And she's like totally creepy. I mean, you wouldn't believe.
The gorilla on the Life magazine cover ass off. There's also this old school Taco Bell product placement.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, man.
We hear a one-sided conversation as we scan the room for pretty pictures. Bunch of green jungle art.
Same note, too. Also, Radio Ethan's radio station is playing in the background. Also, on the computer, someone's playing Doom. I spent a lot of time playing that game.
Maze. Same picture. The shot is slowly panning.
Holy shit.
Across the room, lots of green paintings.
This fucking gorilla suit as Amy is looking at green paint on her finger with no ass.
Man, I'm speechless. The only thing that came into my brain when I saw Amy's face is...
Bingo!
Bingo! Of course she's painting pretty pictures.
And I wrote... file.
Oh my God, what is up with this gorilla? How can I ever describe this to an audio audience?
It doesn't work. If you haven't watched the movie yet, you got to stop this podcast, pause it right now. You got to go watch this movie.
You don't have to watch the whole movie. I'm gonna tell you right now, fast forward to the 11 minute mark.
Mind-blowing stuff. So I really struggle with this throughout my notes because all of the movements and all the acting of the person in the gorilla suit are ass off. But the eyes on the costume are ass on.
No.
And it really fucks with me.
Not always. Well, not always.
Most of the time.
Not in this scene. That's ass off, bro.
The problem is, it's the same expression no matter what. They never change. So if this motherfucker's not staring at green paint on its finger, it goes ass on.
Grant Haslam is encouraging Amy to paint. Good girl. Such a pretty girl.
Shows him a stuffed animal. Calls it her lovey.
Dylan comes in. Amy lumbers over to him.
Who the fuck is this fake ass Steve Gutenberg that just walked in?
Oh, man.
And I refer to him as fake Gutenberg the rest of my notes.
I was trying to place who he looked like. Was it Arliss? I just couldn't.
Arliss? You thought it was Robert Wall?
No, I knew it wasn't Robert Wall, but like just the squareness of his jaw and the beady little eyes.
Wow.
Maybe keep thinking of Robert Wall.
The human in the gorilla suit jumps on him for a big hug. And I thought, he can hold her weight. So I looked it up. Female gorillas around 160 pounds. That's not bad.
Really?
I did a very lazy search. It was the first thing that popped up. I didn't click on any links.
Couldn't have been lazier than this movie.
Exposition that she slept great with no nightmares.
Oh my God.
Are they banging this gorilla? That was my first question.
Time to clean her up. It's showtime.
Which means we got a presentation with some Lawnmower Man / Disclosure level graphics.
Same note too, bro. Cut to a crude 3D rendering of the Lawnmower Man in a grid. Communication. That's what separated human from animal. Speech. Sign language. Alphabet and gestures. Words in motion. Then came virtual reality. What?
Into reality, reality. Not this artificial reality.
This is Lawnmower Man. # justice for Roscoe.
This reminded me that Disclosure had that wild VR.
Yeah, where they go inside to get the files.
Yes, that's where the files are in the computer, is in virtual reality.
But they still had to search. Instead of like, okay, it's VR, so I could just say, hey, give me the Penske file. It just comes up.
No, you got to go find it.
You got to find it, defeating the purpose of it being virtual.
That episode of Community. And Jesus wept.
We see a fat guy covered in sensors making robot arms move. Arliss Wender at MIT applied this tech to sign language.
We see this guy at MIT using a power glove to do sign language, and Stephen Hawking then says what he was saying, and he says, this is the first time I've ever heard my own voice. And I said, well, not really.
Zach, I care about you, man.
Wait, I'm just, it's...
Zach, no.
It's not his voice.
Okay, I thought you were going in a different direction. Whoa.
Oh, where did you think I was going?
Never mind.
No,
yeah,
no.
I mean, where are you going?
Yeah, where are you going?
By the way, the computer robot voice is 20 CB, right?
Yes.
When they all talk like this, I always thought it was fucked up that they made Stephen Hawking still talk like that, even though technology had improved and he could have had a regular voice.
I think that was his brand already by then.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, you can't rebrand.
If you change his voice... then it's not Stephen Hawking anymore, right?
Yeah, you can't do that.
Also, I felt like this dude was lying. I don't know why. I was like, you've heard your shit before, man.
What?
Like, he's heard your shit before.
He's mute.
Calling the man born without organs for speech a liar.
That is... what?
Dylan is trying to get grant funding. People think what he does is a parlor trick. He's going to demonstrate that animals can talk. And here comes Amy galloping down the aisle. She gives Dylan flowers.
Here comes Amy, the human in a gorilla costume, galloping down the aisle.
I have, here comes Amy coming down the aisle like my man from Bloodsport.
Oh, boy.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God. I mean,
that's a big time. Oh,
Amy, how old are you?
Amy, 7. Amy, good gorilla.
And I am fucking crying at the sign language for gorilla. I rewound it. I kept watching it. I am fucking crying at this. Amy is so ass off.
Amy, pretty.
Yes, you are.
This is a talking gorilla, Moira. This gorilla is talking.
I know, boy.
But this is really happening. This isn't Mr. Ed.
I know it's not Mr. Ed.
Reference, repeat offender.
She's got a robot glove hooked up to a backpack that talks for her. The crowd is amazed. We've got ladies with bad haircuts from Zohan's salon in the crowd.
I felt cheated because I thought all these people were going to factor into the story at some point.
Nope.
They're just extras, basically.
No, we got to keep it tight.
That's Mary Ellen Trainer and Stuart Pankin doing a nice day's work with the Mr. Ed reference.
Amy calls herself a mother.
Amy, what? Lunch.
Do you want lunch?
This is where I note the gorilla is ass off, but the plastic eyes are ass on. Tim Curry's in the crowd, and he is horny for this development.
He takes a deep breath, opens a red book, and takes out a gold ring with an eye on it. Very ominous.
Mm.
Nice Illuminati ring there, guy. Also, is the microfilm. And I wrote it thinking like, haha, remember when Tim Curry did that silly accent and stuff? It was really funny in National Lampoon's. Also, when he's pulling out the ring from the box, my man Peter says, Amy's not a freak or anything. I'm like, what? Hey, yo.
Well, he's not kink shaming. You really can't kink shame if you fuck a gorilla professionally, right?
We zoom in on the ring eye, which then transitions to a Amy pretty, pretty picture, and then transitions to something in the jungle?
We get a flashback of sorts, a mini montage with a gorilla's teeth thrown into it. Mm-hmm. Amy wakes up in a cold sweat. Nightmares are back. And I promise I will quit this pod if Amy is an ass off. Because the way this fucking man in a gorilla suit wakes up from those cold sweats, those nightmares.
It's a woman in the gorilla suit.
Yeah.
Whatever. I don't judge that.
Zach doesn't care. It's just ass off.
It's just ass off. Call yourself whatever you want.
When Amy is flailing like a bingo in the bed, that's ass off to you?
My God. Some of the greatest acting we've ever had, by far.
I mean, I think this gives us a nice out to get Zach off the pod.
It sure does, you Babadooks.
That ain't no Babadook. That's
it's darkness. I won't even watch.
Amy is throwing a fit, and this human in a gorilla costume is killing it. Fake Gutenberg is worried about her having nightmares again. It's happened before. Gorillas in captivity, degenerating mentally, having to be destroyed.
Destroyed? That's one way to put it, man.
This motherfucker is going to exposition me to death.
The pretty, pretty pictures made her feel better. Why?
Fake Gutenberg has an epiphany. Thanks to this room with all her paintings, is starting to look like the jungle.
Because it's a lot of green paint.
Tell some old guy she wants to go home. When it comes to Amy, you can get a grant for anything except setting her free.
Dylan wants Amy to teach the mountain gorillas to talk. Oh, please. Making you what? Dr. Doolittle reference.
Buddy, they are going to brutally murder her.
Dude.
The second she gets around those gorillas.
Murder? Oh. That's not the thing. Oh, exactly. That's not the thing that I thought they were going to do.
Oh, God.
She's been over here playing with a doll and stuff, painting. The motherfuckers out there. They're clapping cheeks.
Right as he's saying, no one will fund it. Tim Curry pops up.
I will pay. I will pay for Amy to go home.
And who are you, sir?
Herkema Homolka. formerly of Romania, free now of the chains of Ceausescu, traveling the world, doing good.
Holy fuck, Tim Curry, Louis Pinnock. I will pay for Amy go home.
Lock it in, Louis Pinnock. That's it. No questions asked.
Signed, sealed, delivered. Is Tim Curry the go-to accent guy in Hollywood in this era?
Free now of the chains of Chesico.
Ceausescu. You fucking literate fuck.
I'm trying to say, like, he doesn't fucking say Ceausescu. That's how he said it.
Well, we've actually clipped how he says it, so we'll stack them up side by side and see how you come out here.
Okay.
Ceausescu. Ceausescu.
And I wrote, oh, come on, Herkimer. Yeah, I don't have it quite yet, but man, it's coming up.
Oh, really?
It's coming up.
Oh, come on, man.
Pretzi and Tim Curry would be quite a comic duo in this movie.
The nerd and fake Gutenberg are debating the validity of Herkimer.
No, they're not. They're walk and talks positioning the validity of fake Herkimer.
Grant is dubious of a Romanian philanthropist, and he says, something's voodoo.
What does that mean?
Well, he's got a couple of these little turns of phrase. And then Dylan says, don't look a gift horse in the mouth, which is one of the oldest phrases there is.
Richard, I don't think it's penetrated. We're taking Amy home.
Cut to Dylan and Amy reading a Wild Safari in 3D book, wearing those stupid 3D glasses like it's a Zach Harper headshot.
Amy wearing some non-Oakleys. Just want to make sure we're on record for that. She knows she's going to the jungle. Nerd is terrified. Safari? I don't even like picnics.
Amy is spamming the tickle me sign.
She will not shut the fuck up.
Like Baby Yoda driving IG-11.
Yes, but I thought about Teddy Rex.
I can't stop watching these scenes with Amy and laughing because it is just a guy in a gorilla suit doing all these actions.
It's a woman.
Whatever. The person in the suit is absolutely getting ass off.
Now we're at an airport.
DHL product placement.
Curry wondering about the transport. Is there a problem? Not unless there's a problem. Banter.
Tim Curry might get ass off just with this reaction.
Dylan and Amy on the tarmac. She's messing with the camera. I can't quite see which kind it is, but it's a film camera. He says it's expensive, but I don't believe him at all. He's just a broke boy.
Fake Gutenberg loading up sedatives for her. Karen Ross shows up, introduces herself as a professor. Professor of having your ass on.
Professor, professor, doctor, doctor, clip spies like us.
Doctor?
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 And doctor. Well, we miss anyone?
Have you gotten my faxes, FedExes, and phone calls? 20CB.
My telegrams, my smoke signals, my semaphore code.
We've been putting together a rather hasty expedition to the Congo, the talking gorilla, jungle, me, jungle, 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 me. Shut the fuck up, Amy.
Karen is trying to buy her way onto the trip. I can make it worth your while.
She lives up to her name, Karen. Say, I have the visas. I have the... I'm like, shut up. You feel so entitled to get on this fucking plane. And then she said, I can make it worth your while. And I said, go on.
Meanwhile, Dylan is arguing with the guy taking luggage off the plane. Amy gets jealous very easily. She's already signing ugly woman at Karen. Ugly.
That's what I wrote.
Woman.
Oh, he's
ugly.
Blowing that gorilla's
woman
blackout.
What? Her what?
Her back.
Oh. Oh, God.
Karen's getting pushy. Name your price. I don't have a price. I'm not a pound of sugar. I'm a primatologist.
Fucking nerd.
Put a pin in that one.
Oh.
Because there's going to come a moment where it's like, motherfucker, I thought you, what?
Yes.
Yes.
Herc walks up, says, don't be hasty, introduces himself to Karen.
Ah, come on, Herkimer, that's no way to talk to a dame.
Hey, what's the matter with you? Now you cut that out, talking that way to that dame. I mean, you're acting like some kind of a bull in a 10-cent store or something. You just got here, right away you're on the make.
What am I making?
I just cut it out, that's all. That's no way to talk to a dame.
I don't understand.
Well, maybe I'm being a little rough on you. Maybe you do things differently where you come from. But that is not the way we talk to a dame here, that's all.
What did I say that was wrong?
Just cut it out, that's all. That's not the way you talk to a broad, you understand?
He explains there's been a slight interruption in his credit flow. He can't afford the fuel.
This dumb motherfucker said, I'll pay for the fuel like he's filling up a Hyundai Elantra. But it's a plane.
Karen will do it. 56K. She's smiling because he needs her. Not only is this plane taken off.
Yep.
Boys, we got plot liftoff right here.
Please make sure that your seat belts are securely fastened. All carry-on luggage safely secured. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Karen.
She's pissed. Calls her an ugly woman again.
Erk says they're returning to the jungle from whence she came. And from the looks of it, not a moment too soon. Fake Goodberg, you're the reason she's upset. Calm down, gorilla fucker. Okay.
Yeah.
What? Me? What did I do? Ugly woman. And he says, yes, very, very ugly woman. He'll explain later. The explanation is he's fondling this gorilla and she's just jealous and territorial. That's the explanation.
Yeah.
Everybody buckles their seatbelt to show Amy to do it. She does it, is rewarded with an egg.
And she throws it at Karen.
Fucking chucks it at Karen.
Is that animal dangerous? Humans are dangerous. Gorillas are very gentle.
Here we go.
Amy munches on some celery.
Don't perpetuate the myth.
What myth?
The King Kong myth.
Cobra formula.
Yes, there you go. It's cobra formula.
The myth of the killer cobra formula. There's a good amount of cobra formula in this movie.
Are you so certain there aren't some kind of gorillas that kill? Please, doctor, you can't be serious. What's your area of expertise? Folk singing? Zapped her ass.
Communications technology. So you're a geek with a cellular phone.
Damn, he just told her to go back in the kitchen.
Oh!
He called in a question like, yo, what kind of doctor are you really?
I do real science. I'm a real professor. I'm a scientist, but you and your protege, as far as I can see, belong in the circus.
Woo.
Nerd banter.
Yeah.
Amy's starting to wondering where ground as they fly. She wants her green drop drink. She wants an apple teeny? That was a joke, I thought.
No.
You'd swear they were married. Meanwhile, Curry has thoughts.
The notion of the killer it may be politically incorrect, but that's not to say it's not true. I can't believe what I'm hearing.
Cliches usually contain some element of truth.
Some element of truth. Did he just serve this fucking gorilla an actual martini? And Karen just same note to me.
Same note to Karen.
Oh my God, dude, this is a bean on a flight.
Careful, Mayes. I care about you.
Drinks it so fucking pleased with himself.
She pounds that martini. How would she be so gentle with the glass?
The green drop drink.
She's allowed one. It'll calm her down. Yeah, with a little roofie on the side.
Curry has heard many a bizarre story containing bizarre truth.
And that's it.
Amy slams the martini and burps. Karen looks at Curry in disbelief.
Herc loves it. Karen is working on her equipment. Amy is drunkenly knocked out. Fake Gutenberg comes over and apologizes for calling her ugly. She already knows it's for Amy's benefit.
Look at him crawling back to the pussy, undefeated. Sorry for calling you ugly. Let's fuck.
He's playing both sides.
She's typing on her briefcase laptop, 20 CB.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thing is heavy duty, dude. That thing probably weighs 50 pounds.
Okay, so this fucking nerd.
Yeah, here comes this rant.
She asks why he taught an ape to talk. Why teach it all? Why teach anything to anyone? It doesn't make you rich. It doesn't get you girls. And I wrote, oh, that's why he's fucking this gorilla.
Yeah.
Why did Prometheus steal fire only to turn around and give it away?
Why is everyone in this movie so vehemently opposed to teaching a gorilla how to speak? That sounds pretty cool. All right. Talking animals? That's kind of fucking cool, right?
Guarantee he didn't teach her no.
I don't think this was a condescending question from Karen. I think she's genuinely interested. But then he doesn't answer it at all because he says,
yeah,
there's an inherent generosity in the human spirit. One of its faces is the face of the teacher.
What does that mean?
Nothing.
That doesn't mean anything.
She repeats her original question because he used it as a platform to pontificate his nonsense. Why teach an ape to talk? No practical reason. Then why do it?
What?
A lonely impulse of delight.
That's jacking off.
William Butler Yeats.
Very good.
The very literal definition of jerking off. A lonely impulse of delight. It cannot refer to anything else in life.
It cannot refer to anything else.
A lonely impulse of delight.
I'm with Amin on this one.
Shadow Jacker, you haven't come out of your masturbation cave in eons.
It's high time I emerge from my cum cocoon.
Did it work? What do you mean? You're not lonely anymore? Cobra formula.
And he just says, why are you going to Africa?
Changes the subject.
I found something I lost. And I wrote, what a bunch of fucking nerds.
This was an incredible non-conversation. They didn't actually talk to each other at all.
If he fucks gorillas or the gorilla, does that still keep him as an incel?
Yes, absolutely. Because he clearly doesn't know how to talk to a woman, a human woman.
Thank you for clarifying.
Cut to Central Africa Airport.
I like that.
What?
Not a country. Central Africa. Joey Pants is waiting in a safari hat and a tropical shirt. He's Eddie Ventro. Transportation and equipment.
Eddie Ventro. Intros, position, and banter.
Dylan doesn't like him.
Her expedition. She's just along for the ride. Whatever. Be an asshole.
I don't supply assholes with new personalities.
He asks if they want to sell the gorilla worth a lot of money. Herc wants to know how much.
20 to 25 grand for a female and Amy wants to go home.
Whoa! A talking gorilla! I feel the money hands on the back of my neck going woo woo woo.
Joey Pants is ass the fuck off.
Maze, please clip in. The whistles go woo woo. Bob Rabbit, little sis.
The whistles go woo. When you want a woo woo, it's that woo woo. You know what I'm saying? Then you got the flows. They didn't trip off the flow masters.
That decoration, man. It's just for decoration. That's it. That's all, man. We do it for decoration.
You have it on your car?
Yeah, I got it on my car.
Some neighbors were saying way too loud.
That's only in the morning. You supposed to be up cooking breakfast or somebody, and so that's like an alarm clock. Woo, woo!
She has no idea how to use a balloon. We see soldiers run across the tarmac with guns.
Hiya, fellas!
The vehicle explodes in the background. Joey Pants wants their passports. He fired the arranged guide. Robertson Reynolds
is a bird watcher.
I hired him. You would.
There's also a great moment where he pulls up into park, spits his toothpick off to the side. Ass off, man.
Have to, yeah.
Do you have any idea what's happening in the Congo?
Kagani have had it with Zaire, and they're eating people.
Oh.
Racist.
You go in there with Robertson Reynolds, and you're coming out somebody's bowel movements. Ernie Hudson gets out of a car.
Oh.
Is he doing a British accent?
All-time great mustache haver, not an all-time great British accent.
Boys, just like that, we got ourselves a horse race for Louis Minogue.
Absolutely. He sounds like he's trying to guide Indiana Jones. I don't understand what this accent is.
Monroe Kelly.
I love it.
I loved it too.
I love that he went all in for it.
For at least 3-4 scenes.
Like the intro here.
And then, nah, we need to switch airports, bombing the president's car. That was the president's car? Did they get him? That's the bad news. No, they didn't.
Turns toward Karen. I hope you folks have a lot of money.
I hope you folks have a lot of money.
Money.
We do. Ernie turns a gun on a truck driver in military fatigues and shoos him away.
Run away.
He sounds like Jamie Foxx playing Tony Blair.
Oh, yeah.
On Chappelle's Show.
Yes.
We don't know what he really has.
Eddie will get Monroe a DC-3 to the grass strip south of
Jargon instructions. First the Kagani and Zaire, now this Godfather stuff. Not a good day to be in Central Africa.
What a quote.
Not a good day to be in Central Africa.
What a fucking quote, man.
They hide in the truck and ride out. Eddie will handle all the equipment. Truck gets stopped at the gate. Nerd freaks out. Says he's getting out of there. Monroe grabs him, covers his mouth.
And the nerd likes it.
And they're allowed to leave. He starts licking Ernie's hand. What's going on? Are we safe? Fake Gutenberg tries to calm Amy. Okay.
This yeah.
Fucking,
uh-huh.
All right. Hold on. Yeah. Everybody.
Everybody take a deep breath right now.
Everybody take a deep breath.
Collect yourselves.
We've got one all-time moment here.
Ernie lights up a cigarillo. Amy gets right up in his face as he exhales. He lets Amy take a hit, but Amy wants the whole thing.
He's got the same look on her face as Stanley Jobson when he's hacking and getting blown. You've got to watch this movie, man.
Oh my God.
You're telling me Amy is not ass off? This is what you mean to tell me? Are you fucking high?
He's not, man.
Oh my God. Look at those pictures. Look at the picture I sent, the picture you sent. The fuck out of here. You kidding me?
Until it says, Amy, don't inhale. Are you kidding me?
Is that a Bill Clinton reference?
It's a cigarillo. Ernie Hudson's not lighting up bloods left and right.
But that's the racism of fake Gutenberg, man.
Ernie introduces himself to Karen.
Monroe Kelly, I'm your great white hunter for this trip, though I happen to be black.
This white hunter is black not.
And then he explains that whatever leadership comes into question, they tend to murder everybody. They live for the opportunity to settle scores. He lights up his own cigarillo as Amy continues to puff away. And then this is our new 20 CB clip for eternity.
Yes.
20th century sucks. Maybe the 21st will be better.
Dylan asks if he's some kind of criminal.
Aren't we all?
No, I'm not a criminal.
I'm a scientist.
Shut up, bitch.
Scientist? I ran a few guns. You sons of bitches ruined the world.
Shout out to you.
Dylan doesn't want to be further involved, go their own way. Ernie thinks he recognizes Herc. Asks about Amy from the Virunga region.
You're going to try to take her back to the farm now that she's seen Paris?
Paris?
And this is your cover.
Fake Gutenberg says,
I'm nobody's cover. Cover for what?
He's getting flustered.
Oh my God.
Ernie knows the money being thrown around isn't for any gorilla. Tells him to relax, in better hands than they should be.
Oh, I wrote, we hear guns cuck. I meant cock.
Ooh.
I think.
Guns chuck.
Soldier looks into the flap.
sees Karen and Amy.
The soldier arguing with the driver is Kevin Greavey.
Yeah.
The daisy chain has been activated. There it is. Ever hear people speak a foreign language that you don't speak, but know instantly they can't speak it either?
100%. Yeah.
Well,
everybody talking in this scene, I'm like, you guys are butchering this language.
I felt the whole thing was racist.
The caption that said native language was doing a lot of heavy lifting here.
Cut to an interrogation room.
The driver was Tom Berry, by the way.
Official tells fake Gutenberg that no one can go to Zaire. The border's shut.
Dylan wants to know where his gorilla is. Grant asks if this is a hospital.
So this one's decided to speak.
This is pure Kafka.
Who's Kafka? Tell me! Golden dumpster.
Who the fuck talks like that?
They're at the Hotel Leopold. And they meet Delroy Lindo of the military.
Oh, Captain Wanta.
When he opens his mouth, I said, boys, Delroy Lindo has entered the chat.
We got a three-horse race.
He's ass off. He's Lewis Pinnock.
Have some coffee and cake. Have some.
He goes to kiss Karen's hand. She yanks it away. And she's mad. Legitimate scientific mission. Has no right to detain them.
Liar, liar, your pants on fire.
Takes out a piece of paper as Curry contemplates the cake. Karen used to work for the CIA before TraviCom. TraviCom pays better than the CIA? You have a big mouth.
Everybody says that about me. What can I do? Monroe, you have the worst timing in the world.
Tactical redundancy about the president's car getting blown up.
She hands Monroe a stack of cash as they discuss what he needs.
$20,000.
She says more.
All right, how about another $30,000? Curry's reaction, hornily staring at the money while eating the cake, ass off.
And Delroy is pissed that he's eating his sesame cake.
Stop eating my sesame cake.
Curry looks around confused, like, what?
Stop eating my sesame cake!
He spits it out.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing in my country? You bag of shit.
Captain, please. I only wish to explore and discover.
This fellow is a big bag of shit. You should shake this rat from off your neck. He owes money to everybody everywhere he goes.
So good, man.
This fellow is a big fat bag of shit.
Oh my God, Delroy Lindo, I need more of him in this movie.
I can't believe he was uncredited, man.
Why'd they give him one scene?
You give him one other scene, he gets ass off.
Come on, man.
So underutilized.
For real.
What a tour de force.
Yeah, he dominated this scene.
Karen elbows someone in the junk when a soldier touches her hair.
I like that, Miss Ross. You surprise him.
I don't know why. I thought stapling the bag was a great touch.
Meanwhile, in the back, the guy says, oh, my nuts.
Oh, my nose. Same note, too. You know, it's the gorilla that's going to get you across the border safely. Everybody in my country is so afraid of being seen in an American movie being cruel to a gorilla. This is the crazy world we live in. And he lets them go.
Hit the road, as they say. And have a nice day.
Let the nerds go. Karen says, admit it. You're glad to see me. Pull up to the border at night. Get let through.
Zebra's drinking some water. They arrive at a silver airplane being loaded. Ernie says, what's up to Kahiga, aka Adebisi, who's excited to see him.
Wait, Zach?
Ass on for the zebras.
Why?
Didn't like him. It was so cliche.
They did a good job of being zebras, though.
No, I don't think so. I didn't believe that they were drinking.
What about the vulture that lands on the tree?
Oh, the vulture is ass off, dude. That vulture. Oh, my God. Not since the eagle in Almost Heroes. And we had such a bird performance. You kidding me? Can't teach that.
Yo, Adebisi's there. And now we have a daisy chain into Oz. Him and
Ernie.
I like the idea of a mean daisy chain into the whole series of Oz.
He's ass off, by the way. Adebisi is incredible.
Oh, Kahiga?
Yeah. And this is his first movie. So he's literally always had it. This dude's amazing.
Yeah.
The giraffes peeking out? Ass off.
You didn't think that was cliche?
No, man. They kind of peek out from behind the trees and everything's kind of chewing and looking. Oh, my God. I believed it.
So the guys are loading the plane with the luggage and stuff, and the one guy tells the other in the native language, looking at Amy and Peter, goes, husband and wife, and they chuckle to themselves. And then Adebisi overhears it and repeats the joke louder to everybody and gets this huge roar. And I was like,
thief.
Just stole your man's joke, man. That's not fucking cool.
Carlos Mencia.
Yeah.
Stolen valor. Curry wonders when they're getting to the rainforest. Ernie is dubious.
You're not looking for Solomon City again, are you?
Solomon City again, are you, old chap?
And here comes a very specific kind of exposition that is a horseman nominee. Solomon's position.
I like this, yes.
Good fucking God, man.
disastrous expedition 5 years ago looking for a city called Zinj.
Unfortunately, it doesn't exist. It does exist.
Three members of his safari died from exposure. Fourth was shot by we don't know who. It was an appalling suicide.
We won't quibble. Mr. Homolka here had to be carried out of the jungle by, as I remember it, me.
Shut up, you filthy.
Oh, he's a Romanian. And he has done a lot of good, but mostly for Mr. Homolka.
Shut up, you filthy...
Filthy what? Forgive me. All that traveling has left me shaken.
Think nothing of it. All aboard!
Oh, boy. We almost got a bingo of all bingos right there. Oh, come on, Herc. That's no way to talk to an expedition leader. You remember that ass-off battle we had between Hugh Laurie and Forrest Whitaker in the office scene in Street Kings?
Yeah.
Exact same thing, but a battle for Lewis Pinnock in this scene between the two of them going at each other.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Dylan wonders what all this stuff is. Courtesy of Eddie Ventro. Yo, what pants is there? He got everything from Karen's equipment list, except for the balloon. Future callback.
Yeah.
Plus, JDB wants a call.
I called this Amazon Prime deliveries position.
11 good guys, significant firepower, significant technology. He wishes her good luck and says goodbye.
That's a wrap on Joey Pants. Monroe and his guy put a pill inside a banana.
Dylan wonders how they get across the closed border to Zaire.
A soldier fires a rocket from the ground and misses. Monroe says to sedate the gorilla. They give her the banana with the pill, gorilla Prozac. Karen, in her CIA glory, grabs a flare gun, kicks open the door to the plane.
Yeah.
Unbelievable green screen work here from the plane.
Solid composite.
Of her shooting that flare into the heat-seeking rocket.
Did we mention the pilot's A-plus mustache?
This pilot is ass on, but his mustache is ass off. Zach Harper.
Goes to the mustachery.
Not a note.
Not a note, no.
Not a note for me.
Ernie grabs the other flare gun and joins Karen.
We get some real lethal weapon action here as they both fire side by side to two rockets. She's Riggs.
Fucking fake Gutenberg is asking so many goddamn questions. Oh, shut up.
I wrote fake Gutenberg is full of stupid questions for a scientist.
No, for real.
Why are they putting on parachutes? And she's like, figure it out.
Same note too, Karen. Menage a note.
They start tossing crates of gear out of the plane. Then a guy jumps. Dylan doesn't want to risk hurting Amy, but the pilot and co-pilot are already gone.
You know how to fly this plane?
No.
Curry asks to be pushed, but he's resisting.
I love this.
Harder, please.
Harder.
Push me harder.
And out of BC laughs.
Higa just kicks the shit out of him.
As only he can. He has such a good laugh.
Monroe's got the lady in the gorilla suit with him.
How?
Strapped on.
How do they execute this? A drugged Amy?
He's got to hold on to her. There's no harness.
Well, he holds on to her, but then when he jumps, his arms go free and Amy's holding on to him.
You got to be real confident.
And this whole sequence is pretty cool, I guess.
Landing montage.
Skydiving, red parachutes. See a missile blow up the plane in the distance. Slow-mo explosion.
They would definitely know to come search for them though, right? They saw all that shit getting pushed out of the fucking plane.
With bright red ass fucking...
Fake Gutenberg. We need to call this off. I know when I'm in over my head and I'm no James Bond.
Now you know.
Have you watched the fucking news?
This guy planned the whole exposition and never stick with the local thing. Yeah. Did he even get his shots?
Oh, I guarantee no. He's going to die of malaria in days.
It's like he was going to Hilton Head.
If Laura Linney had not come in and hijacked his mission, he would have died immediately.
Yeah, absolutely.
But my point is, he never did any research, clearly.
No.
About where he was going. He's just like, let's take the gorilla back to Africa. What's the big deal?
He just tried to book a flight on like fucking Southwest.
Yes.
To Central Africa Airport.
He was on kayak.
Dylan is insisting. Ernie says, fine, go wherever. But you should know this is a damn dangerous place and people die here very easily.
Ass off.
Meanwhile, Amy's hanging out with a chameleon.
She's looking at ants. Herc is pumping fake Gutenberg for info. Those paintings.
Those pretty pictures.
You think she was painting something she saw in her life? What a dream, maybe. Such incredibly descriptive detail on these paintings.
Especially the oval shapes.
Just the shape she likes. Something like that. Some shit I don't know.
Karen looking at a Zantrak. Ernie asks if it's a video game.
That's a gadget.
It has features. Ernie's too smart, knows she's picking up a signal.
So why'd you quit the CIA?
I never worked for the CIA.
A little walk and talks position about the CIA.
Of course you didn't. But if you had, why would you quit?
Because they're a loveless
bunch of sons of bitches.
And you're not.
And I'm not.
Glad to hear it.
Good chat.
He is charming as fuck.
He's having the time of his life, man.
Oh my God. He loves this. He loves this. They have Insta-tents. They have air conditioning. Amy is bothering the fuck out of Gutenberg. Monroe asks Herc what Karen is after. What you're after, I've got figured out. What she's after, I don't know.
Decent amount of tactical redundancy and exposition here. King Solomon's diamonds, Lost City of Zinj. So they are after the same thing, diamonds.
Solomon's position.
Now Fate Gutenberg is flirting and chasing Amy. Ah, I said it.
Solomon must have gotten his diamonds from Cartier's, just like everybody else. No.
He is about to fuck this gorilla in broad daylight in front of everybody.
Yeah, the tickle.
This is the end point of Pornhub, isn't it? This is the final video.
It went from a clever cinephobe joke to like, all right, guy.
Now it's getting uncomfortable.
Yeah. Man.
And then Grant goes to smear vitamins in her mouth afterwards.
She loves this.
Absurd.
They are tag teaming that gorilla.
Oh my God.
Karen is setting up a satellite call with her briefcase computer. This is the height of 20CB technology here. She's got a clear signal from the laser's power pack. She tells Jodan Baker, tomorrow they enter the rainforest at the base of the volcanic range. He had the image analyzed. His primatologist says it's something new. Doesn't know what. But it's gorilla-like.
The texture, the flavor, the color, the consistency.
It's very cum-like.
Yeah, so she's sufficiently armed and has enough manpower, then gives her geothermal bad news. Volcanic activity breaking out of the graph. The region's gonna blow. Could be a week, could be sooner.
Good Lord.
Let's tack a volcano onto this movie.
Daisy chain. Amy is running away from Fate Gutenberg trying to fuck her, and all Mr. Travis sees is a gorilla hit the equipment before the link as he thinks it happened again.
God damn it!
God damn it, Dutch!
God damn it, Dutch!
I keep losing people to fucking gorillas.
Not again!
Jeez. That's the link up satellite completely destroyed. There are a shitload of monkey noises at night, by the way.
Ernie is calmly chilling outside.
Oh, he loves it, man.
Full moon. Columbus monkeys.
Mating season. There's a moon like that, every monkey for 200 miles thinks he's Elvis Presley.
That's monkeys?
Is that why Idris Elba wanted to shoot it?
It's a fuck jungle.
Very bizarre nerd tension as Dylan screeches at Karen.
Awkward as fuck. Incel as fuck.
Yes, that's when I knew.
That's when he figured it out. He's still an incel.
This bingo.
They're marching through the rainforest as it rains. I wondered, can you get that gorilla costume wet?
It's a good question.
Amy's medical supplies can't get wet. And then cue a river of hard rain just coming in and said washing him away.
Got a flood.
Ah! He said, are you okay? No, I'm not okay. And I said, shut up, bitch. Oh, my God. These two.
Yeah, shut up, bitch. Might be a horseman.
Horseman, yeah.
Next morning, Amy emerges from the tent. She sees a giant frog or a toad or some shit. I don't know.
Ribbiting its ass off.
Grunts at it, flips open the cooler. Oh, it is ass off. Are you kidding me? It goes sliding off with its ass off.
Yeah.
And she is ass off, slyly eating these bananas. Like, well, as long as they're here, I mean, we might as well.
She's like, I'm going to run a train on these bananas.
Fake Gutenberg wakes up, freaks out, yelling for help. He's got a leech on his dick.
So he's playing with my dick and it ain't me.
The way he woke up, looked down at his dick and then looked very confused. I thought, oh shit, where's the gorilla? I need my morning ritual.
Oh, I thought he woke up, felt something on it, assumed it was the gorilla, and then was confused.
Oh, no. I thought he woke up and felt like something's missing.
Oh.
Amy, I know you like your morning banana.
Oh.
He shows Ernie.
Take it off. I'm not going to take it off. It's your leech. You take it off.
Karen offers to help. Ernie says to burn it off with his cigarillo.
Karen goes, She's fucking ass off.
Dylan hands the cigarillo back to Ernie, who tosses it to the ground.
He just tosses it.
With a smug, disgusted look on his face. Ass off, golden dumpster right there.
There are natives in the bushes behind her.
Mizumu, the ghost tribe, sensitive forest people.
There's probably 20 of them. I only see two. Yes, that's how they are.
Luckily, Ernie speaks the language. They laugh at him being in charge. What's so funny about that?
I'm black.
Oop. Should have luggage on my head.
Oop. Damn, even the forest tribe of people who don't have much contact with civilization, even they're racist? God damn it, man.
Tribeman says there's a dead white man in the forest with a symbol on his clothes.
Draws TC in the sand. Karen recognizes it as TraviCom.
Tom Cruise.
She is ass on freaking out about this.
The Mizumu have several levels of dead, not dead until they're completely dead.
Huh?
Cut to the tribe doing a ceremony. They're all covered in white dust.
Clip this chant. This is a banger.
They haven't moved. I believe his soul has left his body. And if they move him, his soul will be lost, never finding his body again. They're calling to a soul, asking it to come back.
I'm going to sound ignorant on this.
Oh, boy.
But in the movies, I see some of these tribes that are removed from civilization. And yet, some of these tribesmen have a fade. And I'm like, well, how did that happen?
How are hairs cut in the jungle?
Yeah. Why are they always clean shaven?
A sharp rock? A knife? A spear tip? Like, what is it?
Diamonds.
How are you doing that?
Spear tip.
They bring Karen to the front and show her John Hawks, who's deep in a K-hole.
Oh, yeah.
But when Amy approaches, he starts screaming. Then his brain explodes like he got fucked to death for the fellas, and he collapses. Ass off death for John Hawks.
I have this death ass on. Golden dumpster.
Oh, no. I got him ass off.
The way he screamed.
And then he's not breathing, Art. Just so you know,
yeah,
I'm tracking every single one of these motherfuckers.
They start arguing about what inhabits that region. Grey gorilla, impossible. There is no such thing. Two men unaccounted for, Jeff and Charles. Now they're inflating beautiful boats. Money's a wonderful thing. Gave Amy the banana with the dope inside. Dylan gets Amy with the, what's this? And he points to her chest and flicks her nose. Future callback.
He touches her nipple and then he boops her nose. He starts singing California Dreamin' to her, and everybody knows it.
Everyone knows California Dreamin'?
Come on, that's a worldwide hit.
Zach, what the fuck is this movie?
That's the digging a pool in your backyard moment of this movie, despite everything else that's going on. Everyone knowing California Dreamin' and singing it to Amy.
Including the ad-libs.
On a winter's day.
I'm sick and warm, if I wasn't LA.
Cut to them going down the river in rapids. Have you guys ever been whitewater rafting? Have we talked about this before?
Yes. Remember the rapids in Almost Heroes, Zach?
Oh, yeah. God, I love whitewater rafting.
I bet you do, you racist fuck.
What?
Whitewater rafting, huh?
It's because the caps and the... All right.
Mm-hmm. Cap, indeed.
Karen asks Herc about Zinj.
Oh, and some more Solomon's position.
And then he finally, I suppose there's no point in playing stupid. We shall arrive there together. We shall be rich.
That's fine with me, except there is no Zinj.
Half the safari looking for it never came back.
The other half came back with nothing.
Curry says the gorilla is a trumping card.
But we have a trumping card they did not have.
As a young man, I found a book in Soviet Georgia. It contained a detailed drawing of the city of Zinj. The drawing contained a peculiar decoration, an open eye. Later, on safari, I found this.
The way he said detailed. Detailed.
Detailed.
The mitt and the detailed tendon. Incredibly descriptive detailed.
He shows the ring. Same eye as Amy's drawings.
Pretty, pretty picture.
He's a third eye open kind of guy, I guess.
Amy has seen the city of Zinj and she will take us there.
Have you been taking your medication? Have your laughing and I will have mine.
Have your laughing.
Karen lost a signal from the gadget.
She doesn't know what it means.
They're on a lake at night. Slowly going through, they're scanning the water. The boat with Amy and fake Gutenberg goes bump a little. We see bubbling out of the water. Kahiga gets his gun ready. A hippo comes out of the water and grabs one of the porters. This boat is
fuck?
And out of the water comes repeat offender Dan Levitard.
Oh, wow.
This hippo shit is complete chaos.
There are hippos fucking everywhere.
The hippopotamus, he is not one going, cool bean. I am a hippo. No way, Jose.
This is the movie when I found out in life that hippos are evil.
Ernie throws a flare, shoots another hippo that pops up. Grant is losing his mind.
I knew this was going to happen. And I said, shut up, bitch. Although I liked that it was a disembodied voice.
I knew this was going to happen.
Such a bitch.
It's unclear if they kill the hippos or drive them away.
They head for shore. They get to shore. A CGI plane, wow, far worse than that amazing scene in the movie Knowing, is going down from the sky, gets blown up.
It was extra bad because it's at night.
Yeah.
They were unable to match the colors and still be able to see it. It was terrible. Next day, shot of Mount Mukenko. Amy is leading the pack.
She's excited, man. Amy is horny for this.
She's got a backpack on, and I laughed so hard. The sight of a girl wearing a backpack looks so fucking ridiculous.
Power glove.
I know what it is, but it's just seeing the gorilla walk up with a backpack on looks fucking ridiculous, man. Second, they say, hey, it's the pretty jungle.
She was born on the other side of the mountain at the top of the ridge. FG is having a moment with Amy. Is that your valley? Is that home? The lady in the gorilla suit could not be more excited to get to this valley. What's she doing?
She wants to go home to the place in her heart.
You mean the place in your heart, Hecame?
This, as they say, is a fork in the road.
Wrong way. We could lose 2-3 days.
And then young Herc Dukes here says, we must follow the gorilla.
The gorilla.
Where she lives.
There's a point where I'm thinking to myself, this motherfucker sounds just like Borat.
He sounds like John Travolta in Killing Season. He's killing it, man.
Amy wants to go left. Karen would have guessed right, but I don't have her passion. What?
Yep. So they follow Amy.
They've seen her fuck before.
Nerd thinks it's the wrong way. They find the plane that was shot down. Karen says Mr. Travis sent another exposition.
Yep.
Because he thought they weren't going to make it. They keep moving. Nobody survived.
But I do love that there's no dead bodies. There's no equipment. It's just a plane crash. And Ernie says, no, don't check it out. We got to keep going. We didn't dress this set.
Let's keep it moving.
They come across a silverback gorilla making a big scene.
Oh my God.
This is a golden dumpster for me.
If you run, he'll chase me. I know, I've read the books. Fucking nerd.
I said, read the books? Aren't you a fucking professor?
He's a primatologist.
He's making it seem like on the flight over, he read a book about it.
A guy in a bigger gorilla costume gets in FG's face. A bigger gorilla costume that has been spray painted silver on the back. It's gyrating like crazy. Fake Gutenberg looks away like a bitch.
Trying to avoid eye contact.
Like an absolute bitch.
Then he looks back.
Yeah.
And I'm like, is there tension?
Are these bedroom eyes?
Are they about to fight?
They know too. Is he turned on by any gorilla now?
I don't know if you guys ever seen Jamie Foxx's stand-up where he's talking about meeting Prince.
Yes.
This motherfucker is beautiful and it makes you get to like doubt yourself and shit. Like, am I into this? That's what happened with the silverback. He's like, and it just runs away.
Silverback gets frustrated, goes away. Fake Gutenberg looks back. Everyone's hiding behind him. Where'd you go? I ran away. Sorry. He looked right in my eyes. These fucking gorilla costumes emerging from the brush.
Oh, man.
Amy is so ass off looking worried.
You can actually tell how she felt.
No surprise. Amy's a bitch, too.
Says hello. I'm Amy. Good. Amy's a little full of herself, okay?
And the gorillas in the brush say, shut up, bitch.
Amy is so sad and without an ass.
Dylan's gonna take off the voice glove because it makes her weird.
The sigh that Amy gives, that is the most perfect reaction we've had in Cinephobe history.
Very dejected and sad. Slowly collapses.
I'm willing to rename it
no.
The Amy the Gorilla Ass Off Award.
Absolutely not. Not unless we rename it the Tim Curry Lewis Pinnock Award.
Why did you think the eyes weren't good in this movie, Zach?
There's just certain times it doesn't add up. Certain times it does. Okay.
Look at all the pictures we shared in here, man. Oh my God. Eyes
on the Cinephobe Pod Instagram, we've got to release the screenshot of this chat, man.
There's three alone from the smoking scene.
San Diego Superchargers, San Diego Chargers.
doesn't really belong anywhere, does she?
No, she belongs here.
The guy walks into a tripwire. Karen follows it to an alarm box. She wonders where the camp is. 300 pounds of equipment and all the dead bodies are missing. Kahiga is hacking through the brush with a machete. They wonder if it's a dead end. Everyone looking eagerly.
When Kahiga pops out and says, yes, bingo, I fucking lost it.
He's so happy and ass off.
He's so happy to say bingo like he's a mean.
What?
You love saying bingo.
Yes, bingo.
He leads them through a cave to the warm springs. They find a massive stone head with a dunce cap on top of a building or a wall. It looks like Legends of the Hidden Temple.
Some real Olmec vibes.
And Ernie says, son of a bitch, with no accent to be found.
Son of a bitch.
I ran it back a couple times, so I said, what? Ernie?
Same note, too. He completely lost it. And in doing so, lost the ass off award. Okay.
Lost the Lewis Pinnock. I mean,
he lost them both.
No, he's still ass off when he says, son of a bitch.
No, you can't have an accent in a movie and then go, son of a bitch. You can't do that. That's Ernie Hudson walking into the soundstage for the first time and going, they really decorated it.
The plants look like straight plastic. But Zach, say son of a bitch in a British accent.
Son of a bitch.
Son of a bitch.
May sounds a lot more like his regular voice.
Well, I'm a chameleon.
No, Zach, you just sound fucking
whoa! Whoa!
Yes.
I hope bingo. That's super
Curry recognizes it as the city of Zinj. He takes off his ring, says the eyes are the same as the orange ones on the statue.
He's ass off as he looks at the ring, man.
The zoom in on the statue is kind of weird. Why they zoom like that in steps?
Amy looks up at the statue head with bingo fear or amazement. I'm not sure.
I wrote, she sees the eye and is worried? I don't know what's going on.
I got it because that's the eye from her nightmares, right?
Yes, but this is where the eyes fail her on the costume.
Yeah.
Why?
I couldn't tell what her emotion was.
Fuck out of here.
They go through the entry of the temple very slowly, almost too slowly. Bird flies out and scares them. Herc is astounded. Said they built the city around the diamond mine. The savagery of the guards was a legend.
A diamond mine of incredible bounty.
Any transgressor in the diamond flood to the kingdom of Solomon. Why is he turning into young Frank Dukes?
Why did the city die? Maybe the mines ran dry. No.
The diamonds are here.
Kahiga calls them over. We find a Hershey bar wrapper.
Only one person in the world eats Hershey bars, so yep. Karen knows exactly who it is.
She wants a gun and a flashlight. Don't be so John Wayne. You could get killed.
20th century, bitch. John Wayne.
Now that I've said that, I'm not going in there alone either.
Everyone's going in, but Grant will stay outside with Amy and his boat named Live Forever. Hieroglyphics on the walls. Curry says the same ones over and over, including the symbol of the eye. Grant tries to make small talk with Claude from Mombasa. It goes really poorly.
So do you speak English?
Yes.
What's your name?
Claude.
Claude? That's an unusual name for somebody from, where are you from?
Mombasa.
Mombasa? Wow, that's an unusual name for somebody from Mombasa.
Have you ever been to Mombasa?
No.
Then what do you know about it?
Amy's wandered off.
Nerd starts to look for Amy. We hear a growl.
Closed captioning doesn't say growling. It says, grrr. And I said, Tony the tiger?
She's off in the brush and gets scared. A gray gorilla comes up to the nerd. Dramatic music and a cutaway.
And a turnaround. You got to have the ass off turnaround. Like, ugh.
Dramatic horns.
Karen is yelling for Charles in the smoking temple. Molten rock flowing through this whole place.
Lava tubes.
The doors are caved in. Temple rumbles. They hear the nerd yelling. He runs into the temple all bloody. They grab him. And he screams to let him go. He falls to the ground. And that's when a man in a gray gorilla suit comes to the doorway.
And chucks the decapitated head at them.
Oh, my God.
Like Amy threw the egg at Karen earlier.
That gray gorilla's got a chooch.
What the fuck is happening here? There's a whole attack.
We get this weird,
blurry,
blurred motion action.
Terrible.
Why?
Because they couldn't make this gorilla look like it's attacking them.
It was bad lighting. It was bad technology. Blurry slow motion. It's total chaos. Karen shoots it.
They burn it. They shoot it. It's dead.
Another monkey drops down from the sky. But it's just Amy.
I thought that was pretty cheap.
She sees the dead gorilla and walks away.
There's another gray gorilla that comes out and like watches Amy walk out.
Mm-hmm.
And I could tell he's saying, fucking sell out.
Monroe says he never saw an animal move like that. And I wrote in blurry motion.
Dylan calls him some kind of gorillas.
Some kind of a gorilla.
I had that note. I also had from Takers some kind of an accent. They're not quite sure. He's a primatologist, but he doesn't know.
Yeah.
So that's why Solomon's diamonds were never found. Myth of killer ape is true.
Amy says, bad gorillas. I said, no fucking shit, Amy.
Shut up, bitch.
Big help you were.
Let me turn your volume down. Here's your lovey.
They're setting up camp and loading a lot of guns. How are there this many people left?
How have they got this much equipment left?
Good question.
Sensor-operated machine pistols on tripods out there. Anything comes within 40 feet. Get ready for the 4th of July.
Gun goes off. They put on the black lights. Repeat offender.
You got all this shit? And you can't stop some gorillas? Just mow them down.
They're super gorillas.
Yeah, it's not working. They're smart.
They're testing the perimeter. How intelligent are they? Gorillas are very smart, but they're not aggressive. These things are very aggressive.
Gray gorillas lurking in the shadows with red eyes. What are these baby blue lasers that she turns on? I'm not sure what they do.
They're not just motion detecting. They like kind of zap them a little bit.
They zap people, right?
Yeah.
It's like a fence almost.
There's your sci-fi, Michael Crichton.
There you go, man.
You think they don't have that?
Blue lasers that I don't understand? Yes, I don't think we have that.
Okay, Snowflake, sure. The government doesn't have those.
Karen pulls up her briefcase computer, calls Ernie over to show whatever fucking scanner she has is picking up blurry gorilla images.
What is this outline?
One of them charges and the blue laser zaps it. I'm so confused.
Yeah.
Everybody is firing everywhere. How is there possibly enough ammo here?
Chaos, flares.
It all stops. Tree falls down, hits one of the guns on the tripod. They're gone. Monroe says, first light. They're out of here.
Curry comes out of his tent. He translated the hieroglyphics. What do they say?
We are watching you.
Cobra formula.
Cut to the next morning. They can't find any bodies of the gorillas. Fake Gutenberg says Amy's gone.
Two porters and Curry are also missing. Dylan's going to go looking for her. Ernie grabs him by the collar.
People come first, then gorillas. Do you agree?
Yes. Good. Retrieve their comrades, retrieve the missing gorilla, then get out of there. Now mount up!
Cut to Amy in the fields, cuckoo leering at these other gorillas.
Mm-hmm.
This silverback is not having it.
No.
She's flirting like Mayes pretending to be a stripper in a mean story. It is rough.
No, I was way more aggressive.
Hey, baby, wanna dance?
Hey, big boy.
They're walking through the jungle, guns drawn. Find another huge building. Birds fly out.
She hands him the gun and he says, I don't like guns.
She wasn't asking.
You stupid bitch.
Shut up, bitch.
I wish he had said that to him. What the fuck? Do you not see these gorillas ripping heads off and throwing shit? You're like, I don't like guns.
I don't like guns.
And she's like, I didn't ask if you liked it. Take it.
And now we get some hieroglyphs position with incredibly descriptive detail telling the story.
Now all of a sudden he's fucking fluent in these?
Yep.
They get it. They all know exactly what happened.
It says, here's the story of a man named Solomon who was living with some exposition of his own.
They domesticated gorillas. You call that domesticated? So they taught them to be this way. They bred them to violence. They looked for the trait and they encouraged it.
Guard dogs, they turned on their masters.
They find a pile of gorilla bones. This reminded me of the monkey blood, the bucket of monkey blood in Anaconda. The gray gorillas kill regular gorillas and crush skulls. Oh, yeah. Remember that volcano? It's getting ready to blow, man.
Oh, yeah. That shit's still going off. Amy's freaked out. She starts to run away from the gorillas. Part of the temple collapses. Ground gives way. They fall into the secret tunnel. They run out. Herc finds them, says that the way they were going is caved in. The sulfur fumes are making their eyes burn. Amy gets back to camp, grabs her power glove from the tent. They get to this hidden soundstage with little caves and high walls and a flowing creek and a doorway. And Herc says,
it's the mines.
Dylan thinks we are watching you refers to the trainers. And then Curry sees that huge diamonds are sitting in the sand.
Yes. 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 I knew it was true. The city of Zinj. The diamonds. Every word of it was absolutely true.
This is not what raw diamonds look like. Uncut diamonds do not look like diamonds.
Uncut Joms
look like fucking rocks and shit.
They only have one that's correct.
Mm-hmm.
The one that's in Charles' hand.
Dylan suggests he leave it alone. The gray gorillas are peeking out of the caves, but he's grabbing as many diamonds as he can. Ah, come on, Herc!
He's grabbing everything. They look at the doorway for a way out. An ugly ass gray gorilla with freckles stops Herc in his tracks.
It's pink and blue face. It looks like a goblin from Troll 2.
Neilbog.
Mind goblin.
He turns around. Another one cuts him off. He drops the diamonds. A gang of gorillas just attack him. And holy shit.
One of them comes up and slaps him in the ass.
Yeah.
Attaboys him to the ground.
And his head and neck snap back.
They start shooting. And this gorilla gets shot. Like it's Terry Crews and Street Kings, man.
Same note, too. Same note. They light that gorilla up.
This motherfucker is shimmying.
Like fucking Mark Jackson. Like Steph Curry.
They are fucking up Herc. They crush his head. An outrageous number of great gorillas come out and start killing the porters.
More and more and more. The arch leads to a geode, which is a giant diamond.
Thanks for explaining that one, Karen.
Science.
Everything starts rumbling. Kahiga gets got, but goes down fighting like a hero. He's fucked and he doesn't act like a bitch like fake Gutenberg. He just pulls out a knife. He's like, let's go.
Was there any point where you thought one of the gorillas was going to pick up the machete and go to work?
No, I never thought that.
I wondered.
After Ernie looks up from his gun, the next shot is him shooting a gorilla that flies through the air.
Fake Steve Gutenberg. Oh, all of a sudden you're real comfortable with a gun. This motherfucker's unloading.
He's not comfortable. Don't give him that much credit.
He's got a fucking Uzi. He's just fine.
He shoots his gun like a fucking bitch, dude. That might be the most ass-off thing this actor did because he looks like he's never held a gun in his life, but he's hitting gorillas somehow.
Speaking of ass-off, Bruce Campbell dead. Ass off.
In a pile of bones.
Volcanoes erupting. The soundstage has rock formations pushing through the ground. No way back out there. Get through the gray gorillas. They're almost out of ammo. Karen says, I need 2 minutes. Laura Linney gets a laser out of the gear pack.
Blasting monkeys like target practice. Dude. This is when I had the note that Dylan's shooting his machine gun like a fucking bitch. No control over that thing.
This gorilla just did the Stuart. Look what I could do as it got shot. Fake Gutenberg has his gun get jammed. I think that's where you said he shoots like a bitch.
Then he gets grabbed and tossed by a gorilla.
He gets snatched like a bag of flour.
Give me that.
Pulled up and thrown.
Let me get that.
They all surround Fake Gutenberg. When Ro can't get the gun to work, Karen grabs the diamond from Charles' dead hand. In comes Amy and growls throughout the cavern.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Where'd she learn to do that?
Amy.
Where'd you learn to do that? Drug school?
All the gray gorillas go, what the fuck? I didn't know she could do that.
Yeah, they're like, this bitch. This
fucking nerd with her glove.
She signs ugly. Gorilla's ugly. Go away. She is roasting their ass.
She's growling and baring her teeth.
They're confused.
She's like the Jeff Ross of the gorillas.
They've never been called ugly before to just ruin their self-confidence.
Burned.
She calls herself a mother as she starts coddling Fake Gutenberg.
How is this working?
It's a lot more questions I have about their sexual relationship.
I think everyone's as confused as I am, and that's why this is an effective technique.
Maze, it's working because these gorillas clearly not only speak English, but also understand sign language.
Mm-hmm.
Either way, the bases are covered where she says, I'm a mother, and they're like, oh.
That was in the hieroglyphics.
Maternal instinct. Long may she reign. What are you doing back there anyway?
We're getting out of here.
What about them?
Put them on the endangered species list.
Woo!
Tough guy talk finally makes an appearance in this movie.
It's a hell of a line.
She Buster Bluths one of the gorilla's hands off with a laser, cuts through the other.
A loose seal.
If you look at it, it is the exact same look as him with his arm tucked into his sleeve when the thing comes off. They didn't account for like needing to chop a hand off of these gorilla costumes at all.
She's wiping out gorilla after gorilla. The hell is that?
The latest thing in communication.
What?
Cutting down all these gorillas as the volcano erupts. CGI lava comes flowing through.
Liquid hot magma.
When the lava hits the gorillas, the wave of lava, they throw their hands up and their heads back like they're taking a charge.
flop.
Foul on the magma.
That's a flop fine now. That's a technical foul now.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
Talk to Monty McCutcheon about that.
They just start diving in.
Yes. Like lemmings.
They jumped in like it was an Olympic event.
Mays, get ready to supercharge this.
Uh-oh.
Oh, boy.
This might be the most superchargeable thing ever said in the history of Cinephobe. And if you are a subscriber to the Patreon at our $100,000 a month level, you're going to really appreciate this joke.
You get exactly what it means about to say.
It's not like it's... And these people are jumping out of the...
Oh, goodness.
They just literally decide to jump for no reason.
Goodness.
Too soon?
Now, did you... That...
No, you can't leave that in. That's going to make it too obvious. You have to supercharge yourself now, too.
What? No.
This is part of the problem with the supercharge.
You can't riff off of a supercharge?
Not if you're going to supercharge it and make it obvious of what was said. This is the problem.
All right, I'll chop it down.
No, don't chop. Don't chop.
I'll chop it down.
Chop it down to...
No, don't do that.
Yes, bingo.
They climbed up the side somehow. They yada yada'd the hell out of that.
Yeah.
So they're running down the mountain to escape out of Zinj. Lava's chasing them?
A lot of wind, earthquakes.
It kind of looked like the lava was going after them.
Yeah.
CGI is getting out of control. The ground keeps opening up, but then also rising up.
Fake Gutenberg jumps to a rising part of the ground. He's holding on. Amy pulls him up. It's the opposite of what happened to Aziz in This Is the End, where Craig Robinson's like, there's not enough time.
Amy's above him looking, quote unquote, concerned.
I mean, those eyes don't lie half the time. Amy and FG are separated from Monroe and Karen. Karen then cuts down a tree to make a bridge. Somehow doesn't crush them.
Chops it down.
She just knew, I'll cut it this way and it's going to fall perfectly.
Yes.
Unreal.
Scientist.
Unreal.
Science fiction. That laser.
Oh, God. You want to supercharge this note.
Oh, boy.
Zin just collapsing like a...
Wow.
That was in my notes. I forgot I wrote that.
Look at that. Some delayed same note two action there.
Yeah.
Same note bingo.
Yes. Bingo.
They get back to the crash site of the other expedition.
Another yada yada.
She's looking for the balloon case. Fake Gutenberg's looking for Amy. Karen is linking up with Houston.
It's Chekhov's balloon that she said she didn't need before. But luckily, a whole different plane crashed in the jungle so she could use it.
Yes. There should be a yellow case with a... red stripe, but I said red stripe.
Ah.
Hooray for beer.
We haven't seen a time zone difference like this with the Congo since Batman and Robin.
Yeah. It's the middle of the night back in Houston.
She delivers the bad news about Charles dying to Mr. Travis. Did you get the diamond? Did you?
Ass off.
Says, yes.
There's a deep sigh that he hits her with like
a moment of silence.
Good girl.
Clever girl.
Oof. Tension is palpable.
I hate her like exasperated tone. And this is just a Laura Linney thing.
Mm-hmm.
You remember what I told you?
It's Ozark, man. She's talking to fucking Bateman right now. Chewing him out and bitching him out about some shit.
If I ever knew you sent me here for some diamond and not for Charlie.
Hold on.
I would make you sorry.
Is Laura Linney the bitch wife?
No.
Oh, boy.
She's not, actually.
I mean, more than Carlo Gugino.
She's actually the hero of this movie.
What?
I mean, I know, but...
Zach's going to say Amy.
Monroe's the hero of this movie.
Oh.
No. No. Amy's a fuck doll for fake Gutenberg and that nerd, okay?
Oh, come on.
What?
Whoa.
No, not cool.
All right, hit it with a yes bingo.
Yes. Bingo.
He's got to unload a bunch of jargon nonsense here. What would happen to the satellite if I put his phone number in this laser and pulled the trigger? The chip from the transmitter's got the satellite's number, doesn't it? That laser takes a 12,000 channel chip. If you put all that power through that diamond, Karen!
Satellites have phone numbers? Since when?
I have no fucking idea what she's talking about. I know what she's going to do.
I didn't.
She's going to blow up the satellite.
Well, I didn't figure that out by context because they don't actually show us the satellite blowing up. They just show us the laser going into the sky as she shoots the moon like fucking Idris Elba.
We'd run out of budget at that point, okay?
And then static.
Static and turn off the TV.
Because the satellite's down because she ruined TraviCom.
If the laser were that powerful that you could shoot from the surface of the earth all the way up to hit a satellite, I'm sorry. The picture I sent you guys of the gorilla's hand getting blown off.
Oh, that thing would have been obliterated.
It would have obliterated the entire temple.
Yeah, it would just keep going through the rock, through everything. But it's the latest thing in communication, I mean.
Fake Gutenberg finds Amy and they hug. He says she saved him. He says his head wound is okay. Amy seems like she wants to flirt. She gives him a flower.
Yeah.
They sign that they love each other.
She points at his chest. He looks down and she does the flick up thing. Got him.
Got his ass.
Dumb bitch.
She signs mother and he says, oh, I see. It's Africa. That's your mother.
Nope.
What?
Good interpretation, Dylan.
Dylan, that's not what she's saying. As we pan out and we see the fucking silverback gorilla from the beginning of the movie. Yeah.
Good gorillas.
That silverback definitely has plans for her.
Oh, dude. She's looking back and he's looking at Dylan like, that's right, I'm about to fuck your bitch, man. And she's like, he's about to put a baby in me.
Oh, my God.
And Dylan's dumbass is like, Africa's your mother. Like, all right. Sure thing, buddy.
Can a silverback Dirty Mac a human?
I believe we just saw that happen.
Yeah, all right. I'm just asking questions.
Typically, the answer is no, because typically a human's not fucking a gorilla.
Oh, yeah. There's still a volcano erupting, by the way.
Oh, yeah. She runs off. Volcano erupts even more. Fake Gutenberg can't believe Amy's leaving, even though he took her to leave.
Having a really tough time letting her go. I see. She's home.
He doesn't see.
He's so bad.
He's awful.
He's such a bad actor.
Looks back at the volcano, turns around, gorillas are gone. So they take off in a hot air balloon flying over Africa.
That thing's not going to get shot down by border military?
No, because that bright red balloon is not going to be seen by the people who are launching surface-to-air missiles.
Shooting down everything in the sky.
That's the first 5 minutes of Congo 2.
Amy watches them go. Karen takes the diamond out of the laser, tells Fake Gutenberg to throw it away. He throws it horribly.
Ernie says, ouch.
Wouldn't it be smarter to throw the fucking laser away and keep the diamond?
Yes. Or keep them both and take over the world.
It's symbolic, though. Then everybody says a line. There's a wind.
I hope it blows us someplace good.
Me too.
Amy goes to the gorillas. Roll credits, and then the gorillas brutally murder Amy.
For being an outsider
after certain things.
How do they murder? Is it strictly for the fellas?
That's one for the silverbacks.
Who cares if you lose the game? You got this off your chest. I mean, it's just one night of bar trivia.
Ooh. One night of bar trivia is sacrosanct to us.
Trivia is sacrosanct. Buckle up for a shitload of gorilla makeup trivia.
I'm here for it.
Just so that we can backload this, let me just do a couple of quick ones. Monroe Kelly is apparently the role Ernie Hudson likes the most out of his career.
Yeah, personal favorite.
What?
That's some Winston Zeddemore slander. He's just sick of being called Winston Zeddemore.
Wow, he must have been pissed.
Also, he feels like they really fucked him over in Ghostbusters.
I mean, they did, yeah.
Bruce Campbell originally auditioned for the role of Elliot.
Who the fuck's Elliot?
Peter Elliot, Dylan.
Oh, Fake Gutenberg?
Yeah.
Which I'm like, why wouldn't you have Bruce Campbell there? But that character.
Bruce Campbell wasn't a star.
Neither was this motherfucker.
It's a fair point.
Laura Linney at the time had a few minor film and TV roles before Congo, but she was mostly known for her theater work at this point in her career. Her performance is generally considered one of the movie's high points, and she wound up finding more prestigious film work soon afterward. Bruce Campbell said when asked why he decided to be in this for reasons beyond a paycheck, he made note that by all means, the movie should have turned out a lot better than it did, considering the people they got as the writer, director, editor, producer, and composer. On paper, it seemed like an automatic winning formula.
And it was.
All right, Zach, are you ready?
Yeah.
Frank Marshall originally intended to use the computer work pioneered on Jurassic Park for the gorillas, but the computers weren't capable of reproducing hair. Kind of a drawback. We've seen that hair is still an issue in video games.
Hair's tough, man.
And before we dive into the gorilla creation trivia, we need to talk about Stan Winston and Rick Baker, who are two of the most celebrated makeup artists in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
Stan Winston worked on this movie. He won Academy Awards for Aliens, T2, and Jurassic Park. He also worked on Predator. Rick Baker has 7 Academy Awards. He worked on Star Wars, Men in Black, Greystroke, The Legend of Tarzan, Lord of the Apes, and Gorillas in the Mist, which had built a reputation for Rick Baker of creating stunningly realistic apes. If Stan Winston was the, quote, robot man, Rick Baker was the, quote, ape man. Problematic. Stan Winston's naturally competitive nature drove him to challenge Rick Baker's turf. Congo was kind of a proving ground for me, Stan admitted, or at least that's what I had wanted it to be. I wanted to show the world that we could do gorillas too and do them well.
And they did.
Perhaps the most innovative and advanced aspect of Amy was the construction of a single mechanical head that was able to perform all but one of the character's facial functions. In the character effects field, it was typical to build multiple heads to perform a wide range of actions, since a single head did not provide sufficient room to fit all of the mechanisms required to execute that range of actions. Another problem was foam rubber's inability to stretch and contract like real skin as the head went through different facial expressions. Because of those limitations, Stan Winston's crew and other effects practitioners had sculpted more extreme expressions into separate heads, exchanging a neutral hero head with these extreme expression heads as needed. Stan Winston's crew built a second, fully articulated head to fit the larger skull of ape behaviorist Peter Elliott, so not the doctor from the movie, the real Peter Elliott, who would perform some of Amy's more demanding actions.
Speaking of Amy, Zach, according to Frank Marshall, the Amy suit was apparently so convincing that many viewers thought it was a trained gorilla and were amazed at how the Amy scenes were accomplished, frequently asking Frank, how'd you manage to train a gorilla so well?
Same note, too.
Yes. Bingo.
Same note.
Stan Winston's crew life cast the main Amy performer, Laureen No, at the studio, then sculpted Amy over her life cast. For that sculpture, the crew created a hero Amy head that was covered in silicone skin and hand-tied hair. It was one of the first times the studio would use these new silicone formulas rather than foam latex for a character. The main advantage to silicone was that it simulated the translucent look and feel of real flesh far more convincingly than foam rubber.
Sure did.
But silicone had disadvantages as well. When we were first experimenting with it, said Shane Mahan, we found that it was too oily if we didn't get the exact formula right. The oils would come soaking through and ruin the paint. We had to figure out what kinds of paint worked best with it, how to attach mechanisms to it. It is heavier than foam rubber, so there was a weight factor we had to learn to deal with too. Today, silicone formulas that have advanced far beyond those used for Congo are industry standards for makeups and puppets requiring a fleshy look. Stan Winston's studio created 12 genetically mutated gray gorillas for Congo, 8 of which were built as fully articulated hero heads and suits. To initiate the design of the 12 grays, Chris Swift rendered a series of drawings. Stan Winston then gave key artists at the studio the opportunity to design and sculpt one unique character each. Because the grays were a fictional mutant breed of gorillas, the sculptors enjoyed a lot of creative freedom in devising their designs. Stan really let us use our imaginations in coming up with something unique and specific for each of our characters, recalled Joey Orozco. Greg Fiegel, for example, sculpted an amazing gray gorilla that was a combination of a man's face, a chimp's face, and a gorilla's face. I based mine on the features of a gorilla and a chimp, and then came up with an interesting paint job to make it look as if my gorilla had vitiligo, the pigment disease that discolors skin. What? In the final film, the distinctive characteristics of the 12 gray gorillas so painstakingly integrated into the original sculpts were undetectable, as the characters were only seen in quick cuts. The gray gorillas could have been more than what they were, Stan Winston admitted. As wonderful as these characters were when we were looking at them at the studio, as wonderful as they could have been, they wound up looking like a bunch of guys running around in gray fursuits, mainly because of the limitations of the set and lighting. Passing the buck. Problems with the grays in the design stage only intensified when the characters started shooting. The mine in which the gray scenes were set was essentially a large empty cavern of red rock. There was no foliage of any kind, and without it, director of photography Alan Davio was unable to justify the kind of dappled lighting that would have gone a long way in making the grays look more authentic. In any kind of creature work, Stan Winston commented, so much of its success depends on the lighting and setting those characters are in. I wasn't at all happy with the gray's environment. That big red cave didn't allow for interesting or dramatic lighting at all.
Yeah, that was the problem.
Mm-hmm.
This might be my favorite piece of trivia. Zach, the diamonds that they used in this movie came from a diamond mine in like New York.
Okay.
And they weren't real diamonds. They were just
doubly terminated quartz crystals.
The diamond that was thrown out of the balloon at the end of the movie was lost, so it could not be returned to the fucking people they borrowed it from.
They really threw it?
Also, the name of the diamond mine was Herkimer.
Ah.
So they named Tim Curry's character Herkimer.
Herkimer.
The hippopotamus that attacks the team in the movie was a 2.5-ton animatronic puppet controlled by off-camera puppeteers. A one-handed telemetry device controlled the head and neck, while other puppeteers operated the animal's ears, nose, and eye movements. Its body was made from fiberglass, and silicone was used for the skin. Contrary to popular belief, the lava effects were not CGI.
What?
They were created in miniature using a methyl cellulose mixture and composited into the final shots.
Bullshit. I don't believe it. I know CGI lava when I see it. Okay.
It's like when Adam Sandler said he didn't want to use a bodysuit or whatever, so he actually worked out and got in shape.
Bullshit.
Hugh Grant and Robin Wright declined leading roles.
That's a very different movie.
Michael Crichton originally conceived Congo as a vehicle for Sir Sean Connery after working with him on The Great Train Robbery. He envisioned it as a modern-day version of King Solomon's Mines, with Connery playing a character akin to Alan Quartermain. Crichton's insistence on having a real gorilla play Amy stalled the project, and it remained on the back burner for over a decade. Connery ended up playing Quartermain in The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Godphobe.
And finally, in a Mandela effect type situation, viewers have said that they distinctly remember a scene in Congo where one of the gorillas fires the laser gun. Yet the existence of this scene has not been proven.
I kind of do too.
There was a version where they wanted the gorilla to pick up the laser and start shooting with the laser, but ultimately they decided against making it. So there was like an intention for it, but it never actually happened. But in my universe, the gorilla doesn't pick up a laser. He picks up the fucking machete that Adebisi drops, and then he goes to town.
Yeah, I like that. I wish Faye Gutenberg had died. He didn't deserve to live.
No, he didn't.
Really, Amy should have killed him.
On the other hand, Monroe surviving. That's a big upset right there.
Yeah, that is a big upset. Good for him.
I'd like you all to do an experiment on a plant, something that may benefit mankind. And if you devise something that groundbreaking, I guarantee you an A in this course.
Whoa, hold on, man. You firing me? You can't do that, Lionel. Look, man, if you don't want me to have a foreman job, I understand, but I need my fucking job, man.
Lewis Pinnock Accent Award.
Wow.
You've got Delray Lindo in his one scene as Captain Wanta. You've got Ernie Hudson arbitrarily deciding to be British. And Tim Curry's very special Romanian accent.
I wish Delray Lindo was around long enough.
Yeah.
Because he would have swept all these awards and stuff.
Especially the sesame cake part.
It's got to go to Tim Curry because
he didn't break.
Slow, steady drumbeat of excellence is Tim Curry.
Let's show them who the horsemen are, guys.
Yeah, we got soul.
Horsemen, jargon, 20 CB, nerd banter, soundstage,
gorilla costumes.
Shut up, bitch. That's my pick.
I would also say yes, bingo.
Yes, bingo.
Solomon's position specifically. But guys, I have a different submission.
Oh, submit it.
I submit to you the myth of the killer ape.
Yes, I'm in for this. I'm in for the myth of the killer ape.
Breathe in through nose, out the mouth.
Ass on, ass off.
Teddy Rex, Moosey Teddy Rex. Teddy Rex, Moosey Teddy Rex.
Ass on, fucking ass off. Ass on, fucking ass off.
Michael Biehn Memorial Ass On Award.
Oh boy.
I'm nominating Jodan Baker. No. I'm also nominating Amy sometimes. No. I know that's just going to make Zach upset.
Me too.
But it's Dylan Walsh.
Yes.
That's Faye Gutenberg?
That's Faye Gutenberg.
Yeah, absolutely. Get his ass on there.
Much more loaded category. Carl Weathers Memorial Ass Off Award.
Loaded. It's loaded when there's one.
Tim Curry, Joey Pants, Ernie Hudson, Delroy Lindo, Amy the Gorilla sometimes.
All the time.
Also, Adebisi was great.
Well, Lenny was ass off.
Oh, I thought she was terrible.
No, come on. She was acting her ass off, man.
You remember what I told you?
I mean, okay. She did the best with the shit that they gave her. That's not her fault. She didn't write that shit.
It's Amy, guys. Come on.
You'll get no argument from me.
Wow.
Amy is unbelievable in this movie.
Wow.
I refer you back to the gorilla scene.
The defense rests, Mayes.
The problem is all the like true contenders didn't have enough scenes.
That's true.
Delroy Lindo didn't have enough scenes. Joey Pants.
Is Ernie Hudson's accent going away? What's taking it away from him?
It broke it. Yeah.
Absolutely, yes.
Amy never broke.
She absolutely broke. There's a lot of times where I did not know what Amy was supposed to be doing, dude.
You guys are tripping.
Oh, get out of here. It's a gorilla. How do you get in the mind of a gorilla?
Are you good at keeping secrets?
Absolutely.
Because I've got a present for you. Secret present outside by the dumpster.
Is it a baseball mitt?
fit you like a baseball mitt, like a glove. I hope.
Golden dumpster nominees. Mm-hmm. Amy drinking a martini on the plane.
Yes.
Amy smoking a cigarillo in the truck. Delroy and Curry back and forth with a sesame cake. The parachute sequence. Dylan burning a leech off his dick with a cigarillo, then handing it back to Ernie, who disgustedly tosses it. And then put him on the endangered species list before lasering through a horde of gorillas.
Allow me to add a couple more. Amy painting.
Yeah, I thought about it.
The first time we see Amy.
It wasn't so much her painting. It was just seeing Amy for the first time.
The reveal.
Ernie Hudson saying, I'm your great white hunter for this trip. I just happen to be black.
Otto BC saying, yes, bingo.
Karen Ross going, when he says, burn it off. Let the leech. Bob waking up and then dying with his ass on. You guys disagreed. You guys thought like Bob was ass off.
Yeah.
He was ass off in that moment, man. I got one more. Who is Kafka? Tell me.
For the second consecutive movie, a martini will be part of my golden dumpster.
Wow.
But I can't separate drinking a martini on the plane and smoking a cigarillo in the truck. So it's going to be Amy drinking a martini and smoking a cigarillo. Can't ask me to choose between my two favorite children here.
Mine's going to be the scene by the plane where Tim Curry and Ernie Hudson are just having a Louis Pinnock off.
Oh.
And he almost calls him the N-word. That scene is, oh my God.
The up scene?
That scene is unbelievable. That's going to be my golden dumpster.
May, since you already picked the cigarillo, which was my absolute favorite scene, I'm going to go with the guy at Berkeley saying, met this girl named Heather, and she's like totally dreamy. I mean, you wouldn't believe.
His embodied voice.
It was ADR. That's a weird thing.
Yeah.
We see him, but they ADR'd the fucking dialogue.
Well, Zach, you picked it, motherfucker.
Motherfucker. I like that.
Overfile.
Guys, I like this movie. I'm not even going to try to like, oh, it's twist and turn. This is a file, man. I still like this movie to this day. It's not good. It's fucking ridiculous, but I get so much fucking enjoyment out of this movie, out of the gorilla costumes, Ernie Hudson, Tim Curry. I love it all. Not even fake Gutenberg can ruin this for me. There's just so much happening with Amy. She drinks a fucking martini on an airplane like she's Michelle Beadle. I fucking love this movie. This is a file.
Maze.
I was shockingly on the hook for the first hour and 10 minutes. I was very interested. I enjoyed the adventure into the jungle. I thought they were doing maybe a few too many things at once. We've got the Indiana Jones style diamond mine quest. We need to return Amy to her homeland. You've got the communications laser plotline that I still haven't totally wrapped my mind around what they were going to do with that laser if they got the diamonds.
I think they were going to blow up satellites.
Shoot the moon?
Yeah, shoot the moon.
It's a lucrative business. The third act was a fucking mess. As soon as they showed up at the Lost City of Zinj and the gray gorillas come out and that chaotic scene at night where they're setting up camp and gunfire is going off like crazy. And then when she gets the laser and, oh yeah, there's a volcano that's also erupting. Let's throw that in the mix. It was a lot. I'm still going to file it because I enjoyed it a lot. But the third act, they just did too many things, man.
Wow. How about that?
I mean,
this movie's terrible. It's truly awful. It made no sense. The story was boring as shit. The bleed up to just get to the point where we see killer apes took way too long. And I was so frustrated watching this movie. And yet, oh man, I laughed.
No way.
I laughed so much.
No way.
The purest metric for like, is this a Zephobe or a file is, would you watch it again? And I cannot wait to show people this movie. Just so that we can watch all these scenes with Amy and laugh our asses off. Boys, green sweep that bitch.
Wow. I thought I was going to be alone on this. I thought there was a chance Amin would file it. I thought Maze was a for sure phobe.
Much like Street Kings gave me Taker's flashbacks, I was getting Anaconda flashbacks.
Oh,
and I
yeah.
thought for certain that Amin would block this one like he blocked Anaconda. But apparently, if there had been a human in the Anaconda suit and the Anaconda had smoked a cigarillo, maybe Amin would have filed Anaconda.
Oh my God. if the anaconda was smoking, or if the panther, maybe the panther had smoked some.
It blew a panther's back out. What do you mean? What are you talking about? Amin phobed that? Come on, baby bird. You can't phobe that.
Martini on an airplane? That's breakfast on the river.
Make sure you're sending us your plot liftoff, your Lewis Pinnock, your five horsemen, your ass on, ass off, your golden dumpster, your phober file at Talk Hoops, at Darth Amin, at Corn Puzzle, at Count the Dings, and make sure you're following at Cinephobe Pod on all social platforms.
You want to see photos of Amy the gorilla smoking a cigarillo and drinking a martini?
Oh, yeah.
It's just got to be the text thread. Can't stress that enough, that it can't be just the pictures themselves. It's got to be the text thread.
Yes, bingo.
Next time we make love, you introduce me to Jade.
Shit, what is it, my pick next?
Nope, you just picked Congo. It's Amin's turn.
Oh, boy.
It's my turn. It's my turn.
You going to daisy chain off of Amy the gorilla?
You know what? Didn't even think to do that. I was stuck between a couple of things. I thought about, there's another Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I just like the idea of completing the collection there.
Oh, yeah.
There's also the sequel. Typically, we do a sequel first and then the prequels.
Congo 2?
No, Smoking Aces 2, oh. Assassin's Ball.
Oh, yeah, that's a good name.
Thought about doing Leonard Part 6, which is a Bill Cosby movie. I didn't know if the world was ready for that.
Oh, my God. What? No, don't.
Fuck, I just realized I don't know if this is a rental or not. Oh, yeah, it's on Roku. Got it.
Oh, I don't have Roku.
Too bad. The Dukes of Hazzard, baby. Let's go.
What?
The one that came out in 2005.
What's the daisy chain?
It's Joe Don Baker. He plays Governor Jim Applewhite.
Wow. Oh, it's on AMC. AMC Plus.
Back to Knoxville, huh?
Repeat offender.
Oh, Mays. You could Jessica Simpson right into Employee of the Month.
Oh, no. Fuck.
Oh, yes.